Good evening, students, or good morning or good afternoon, whatever time zone you are facing. I welcome you on the day three of this audit and assurance practice to pass webinar for the September 2021 exam. And today is the day three. We have already covered audit risk on day one. We have already covered internal control systems on day two. And I hope all of you are feeling pretty confident now because you have covered more than 50% of your course, more than 50% of your exam content, more than 50% of the exam requirements. So far, as far as the first day was concerned, we did audit risk and we realized that audit risk could be tested in two different forms, but the exam requirement will be the same. The first methodology of testing the audit risk question is that examiner is going to give you a story, a scenario, and you have to describe or explain the audit risk, and then you have to explain the auditor's response against those audit risk. The second methodology of the examiner is that the examiner is going to provide you a set of information in the context of a scenario, but along with that, the examiner is going to give you an extract of the financial statement as well. And you got to utilize the analytical procedures, you got to utilize the ratios and the trends, and then you have to explain the audit risk. That was the day one, and then we moved on to day two, and the day two was a hectic day because there were too many exam requirements on the day two. First of all, we realized that internal control systems are the policies and procedures. These are the rules and regulations, the do's and the don'ts. You have to do this, but you are not supposed to do that. So these are the do's and don'ts, which we call internal control systems. And in our AA syllabus, we have got six internal control systems. The names are sales, purchase, inventory, payroll, bank and cash, and non-current assets. And I truly believe, and I genuinely believe on this particular statement, that if you are good at one particular internal control system, you are automatically good at overall all the topics of the internal control systems. So if you can prepare one internal control system under the supervision of a tutor, someone who can guide you, let it be me or anyone else, you just need a lecture from an expert tutor for one particular system. And after that, if you have got common sense and if you're willing to work harder, I think it's a walk in the park. You can do it on your own. As far as internal control systems exam requirements are concerned, we realize that examiner could ask us to explain the deficiencies, then come up with the recommendations, and then examiner might ask us to test those recommendations, that is, provide a test of control. And there is one more different requirement as well, that is, examiner could ask you to explain the key controls, the strengths of the systems, the positive attributes of an internal control system, the good controls, whatever you call it. So that was the day two. And we realized that internal control systems and audit risk do have an element of monotony. If you are going to prepare 2-3 questions of audit risk, 2-3 questions of controls, automatically you will be on the track. Automatically you will start feeling confident. Automatically in every exam requirement or in every question, more than 50% things will be already, you will be having a familiarity level of it. So If you are willing to work harder for at least first few, remember every topic of audit and assurance, whether it is audit risk, whether it is internal control system, whether it is substantive procedures, whether it is ethics, or you name it. For every topic, the first couple of questions, first 2-3 questions which you solve or which you go through are always difficult. Once you have understood those 2-3 questions, once you have, you know, worked harder on those 2-3 questions, once you have typed and learned those 2-3 questions, it automatically becomes easier. The path automatically becomes easier. So you have to back yourself and you don't have to panic, and you have to motivate yourself that yes, you can. Yes, you can. If you can type and learn those 2 risk questions called whatever their names were, I think Harlem and BlackBerry, and if you could type and learn those 2 control questions, very difficult control questions, Freesia and Raspberry, if you could attempt to type and learn those 4 questions, the risk and the controls will not create further problems for you. One last thing from the risk and control section, those four questions which we have already solved in the day two and the day one of this session are the most challenging questions. So if you have mastered those four questions, you will find relatively easier questions then. So that's a statement for the sake of motivation. Okay, let's start the day three formally. And as far as day three is concerned, we must remember that the exam format is a challenging one. We must recall ourselves that we need to invest quality time on OTQs. We did a couple of very tricky OTQs yesterday, and I have promised this with myself that I will be doing at least two more OTQs today. We need to make sure that OTQs are part of our daily routine. Once these overall five sessions or the overall this AA webinar is over, you have to attempt at least three OTQs, or I would highly recommend or encourage six OTQs per day. So you got to make sure that OTQs are part of your daily life. The way you use Instagram, the way you use any other social media platform, the way you use WhatsApp, the way you eat, the way you drink, the way you sleep, the way you perform your other co-curricular activities, just like that, you need to make sure that the OTQs of AA are part of your daily life. And I really hope so on this note that you are going to make a promise with me, and more importantly with yourself, that you are going to continue with OTQs. Those students which are quality students, do they fail this particular paper? Yes, they do. And when I audit them, or when I inquire them, when I have a discussion with them, that's the language of an auditor, inquire, discuss. And when I discuss things with them, when I inquire things with them, they come up with a very sorry answer that they did not pay enough respect to the OTQs during the session. And as a result, they were having a nightmare during the exam when it comes to Section A. So please do give respect to OTQs. We have got three major areas. We have got four minor areas. We have already covered two major areas, that is risk and controls. And today is the day for the most important part of the syllabus, that is substantive procedure, the third major area. By the way, all the minor areas will be covered on the day five. So hang on, and ignoring the minor areas is one attribute of failure students. So don't do that. Okay, one last thing before I formally start my topic for the day. Why students fail this particular paper? Students are going to fail, unfortunately. Students are going to fail, and students have failed this particular paper because of their poor typing speed. So you should work on your typing speed. Make an account on typing.com, invest 1 hour daily for the next 30 days, and you will rock. Lack of exam practice. Make sure whenever you are attempting a question, make sure it is time bounded. Make sure you are not bothered with the doorbell. You are not bothered about your cell phone. Make sure the TV is switched on. Make sure you are fully focused on that particular question. We have to give respect to the OTQs. We are not supposed to score poorly in Section A. We have to make sure that on a daily basis, we type something with respect to knowledge based. Develop or create a file on your laptop, a Word file, and daily add something in it, such as the definition of fundamental principles, ethics, the definition of audit risk, the definition of risk of material misstatement, the definition of materiality, the definition of narrative notes, the definition of flow charts, the definition of, let's say, performance materiality. So the things will go on, and you need to develop your own knowledge base. Second last reason of the failure students is the exam technique issue, but the exam technique issue will be resolved. I'm sure you are feeling confident with respect to risk. I'm sure you are feeling confident with respect to controls. And within a day or two, you will be feeling confident with respect to substantive procedures. So exam technique is not a problem. Let's continue. Last but not the least, you are not supposed to ignore the minor areas. And the minor areas, at the end of the day, they tend to make up 30 to 40% of your exam. So obviously, you're not supposed to ignore them. Okay, then let's start the third major area, and fortunately the last major area and the easiest of all. Yes, it's the easiest of all. It's easier as compared to audit risk. It is easier as compared to internal control systems. So what are we waiting for? I think we need to cruise. We need to get rid of this these substandard procedures so that we could feel confident. Okay, hold on a second. Just imagine for a moment. You are good at risk and controls already. Just assume or just let's be positive. Let me be optimistic. And just imagine that you had a good session today and you had a wonderful session day of tomorrow. Now just imagine substantive procedures are also a strength of you as a student. So you are good at risk, you are good at controls, and you are good at substantive procedures. Now what's the problem now? What is that factor or what are those factors which can lead to a failure? I really don't think so, because you are going to work on OTQs on a daily basis. You're working on your typing speed and your knowledge base stuff. And the all three major topics are well covered. All minor topics will be covered on the day five. So I don't think so that any one of us should be thinking about failure. I think we need to stay positive, aggressive, and we need to make sure that we capitalize on today's session on substantive procedure and the tomorrow's as well. Okay, substantive procedures. Before I start substantive procedure, if there is any question, let me check and let me answer that. Please add me on WhatsApp. Please add me on WhatsApp. Okay, fine. Confident than ever. Thank you very much. I'm loving it. How much marks we have covered up till now? Mars is asking. At least 20 marks on risk, at least 20 marks on controls. That makes 40. At least 10 marks on OTQs out of risk and controls. That makes 50. Maybe a knowledge-based requirement. Okay, let's ignore that maybe. So at least 50 marks, Mars. Mars, how does that sound now? Okay, salam, sir. Okay, so today teaches how to. Okay, sir, please repeat the four questions name also. Four questions which we covered on day one are Harlem, Blackberry, Raspberry, and Freesia. I'm going to share a file with you today, and that file will help you. Don't worry. Okay, minor areas will be covered on day five of Ahmed. Grateful if you could advise which section. Oh, that's a tricky question. So Vidisha has asked me a question that which section should be started first in the exam. See, this particular question has got different answers for different exams. If I'm teaching AAA, that is Advanced Audit and Assurance, I generally recommend to start with section B. But for audit and assurance students, for AA students, I would highly recommend with huge amount of confidence to start with section A. Why I'm saying that? Section A is a very, very, very delicate section. So you got to start your paper from section A, because if you are tired mentally and physically after 2 hours or so, or 2.25 hours or so, and you are left with 40, 45 minutes, which is a reasonable time, but you are mentally tired, you are drained, there is a huge possibility that you might commit unnecessary fumbles, which I don't want. As you have realized from the day one and the day two of the webinar, the OTQs are way too sensitive. They are very critical. A little bit here and a little bit there, and you're gone for all money. So I would highly encourage and I would highly recommend Vidisha and everyone to start your exam with section A. Is this clear? Mr. Sarosh, I am going to share a short video on the WhatsApp group today, and that will help you out how to copy paste stuff. I'm going to share a video tonight on the WhatsApp group. So let's leave this particular issue for now. Okay. Okay. There is another question from Mr. Matthew. That is, how many control objectives we need to memorize? There are six systems, and for every system you got to learn at least three objectives. So 6 3s 18. Yesterday I was saying at least four objectives, but four or three, even if you could make four, 6 4s are 24 objectives. Sir, how much time we need to spend on long questions? Okay, Ajwa, I'm going to develop this whole thing and I will be sharing on day five probably. You got to remind me again. Thank you, Ajba. Okay. Okay, Somya has asked the same question. How much time we need to spend on section A and section B? Roughly speaking, you can't exceed 40 minutes, more than 40 minutes on OTQs. So the 40 minutes is for OTQs. But for other questions, I'll make a breakup and I'll show you tomorrow or day after tomorrow. Most welcome, Sarosh. Okay, Manasa is asked for section A questions. Can Kaplan practice kit sufficient or do I practice BPP section A as well? Manasa, if I could give you a third kit called Ahmed's kit or the fourth kit called Manasa kit, I would beg you and I would request you and I would encourage you to solve those kits as well. So I think I've answered your question. Kaplan kit is not enough. BPP kit is not enough. You got to solve both kits at least twice. And if you are going to solve six OTQs on a daily basis starting from tonight, I think things will be smooth and no problem will be faced. Thank you, Vanessa. Most welcome. Okay, Vidisha, most welcome. Okay. Okay. Okay, Shreya has asked a question. I'm asking this question on behalf of my friend. He started procedures chapter today. Will he be able to manage it along with exam quit questions? Shreya, if that student knows nothing about substantive procedures, and if that student is listening to me right now, I'm confident that that student will be able to grasp 99% of the things. And if there will be any loophole or any deficiency from my side, I will cover it up on the tomorrow's lecture. Have you realized, Shreya, that substantive procedures have got 2 days, the day three and the day four? So don't worry. Okay. Mohammad Hussain is saying, what should be the best way to clear basic concept of control systems? I'm struggling with this. Hussain, I would advise you to A, attend yesterday's webinar altogether again. If you are still not feeling good about it, contact me and I will share, or even if you could ask in the WhatsApp group, somebody is going to help you out with the day two of the last session's webinar. Day two, I'm being specific. Day two of the last session's webinar. So that is going to give you another, you know, morale booster and another help. So after those two webinars, after those two lectures, you will start feeling good. And still, if you have got any problem, you can contact me later. Okay, Neha Fatma has asked a very easy, simple question. How many questions do we need to solve every day with regard to section B questions? Section B. I think if somebody is going to read six questions per day, it's not good enough. But if somebody is going to type and learn two questions per day, 130 mark, 120 mark, 130 mark, 120 mark, and type and learn, I would say two thumbs up. So six OTQs, Neha, and along with that, at least two long questions from section B, one for the 30 mark, one for the 20 mark. Make sure you attempt all the parts. Don't skip any part. Don't ignore the knowledge-based questions. How does that sound, Neha? Sir, which area are more focused by examiner for knowledge-based questions, minor or major? That's a tricky question. There is no sure short answer to that. Sometimes the examiner is going to ask you to explain the definitions of the ethics. It's a minor area. Sometimes the examiner is going to ask you to define audit risk. It's a major area. So, Abdullah, don't bifurcate those things. Just try to come up with your own set of knowledge base for all minor and major areas. Most welcome, Neha. Okay, I think we have got good enough questions. Let's start the main topic. Okay, how does that sound? Should we start the main topic? Okay, then. Okay, then. Okay, okay, okay. Muhammad Azan has asked a question. Muhammad Azan is asking, which are the confirmed areas to be tested in section B? Risk, controls and procedures, the three major areas. Simple as that. Uh, Burhanuddin, I can wait. I'm already involved in this question answer session. So I'm going to give you another 2 minutes. I'm going to start the main topic after 2 minutes. There are time differences, Burhanuddin. I hope you can understand this. There are time differences. I can't manage all the time differences. Okay, Sarosh, I'm going to wait for 2-3 minutes. Meanwhile, if there is if anyone has got any query, anything anyone would like to know anything, if it has got nothing to do, even if it has got nothing to do with audit and assurance, you can ask. Okay, go on. The next 3 minutes are chit chat. Let's start the chit chat. Okay, Gautam has asked a question. Can you provide me with a list of questions for knowledge base covering the entire syllabus? Yeah, I can. So at the end of the fifth day, once the 5 days are over, I might provide you a PDF file in the WhatsApp group, Gautam, and through which you can cover your knowledge base. But Gautam, let me be very honest with you. This is not recommended. Ideal case for you is that you create your own list of knowledge base. You create your own file, type your own knowledge base. Okay, Gautam, you got to create your own file. In fact, you got to share your file with other students. Thank you, Gautam. Okay, another question is, okay, Ahmed Farhan, I can tell you something out of it, and that is you got to walk for at least 40 minutes on a daily basis. You got to walk for 40 minutes on a daily basis. By the way, if you are not having good enough, you know, physical activities in your life, and if you're not working on your physical health, if you're not walking and if you're not doing some physical activities, jogging, running, swimming, whatever it is, this ACCA becomes a very difficult activity. Then all those students which are physically active, boy or a girl, the qualification becomes a lot more easier. So go on for a hike or something. Okay, Irshad Ali has asked, any tips for PM? Oh boy, this PM is a nightmare. PM is the most challenging exam of the ACCA, mark my words. And you got to solve both kits, all the MCQs and OTQs from Kaplan, all the MCQs and OTQs from BPP. You got to make sure you are good at, you know, assessing the performance in accordance with variances. You are good at it and assessing the performance in accordance with ROI and RI. You got to make sure that you are good at non-financial performance indicators. Balance scorecard should be good. Transfer pricing should be good. Hassan Abdullah, you definitely have passed PM. That is why you are saying PM was easier. But once you will pass AA, then you have to text me up and then we'll have a discussion and then you'll say, yeah, sir, PM was a bit more difficult, a bit slightly more difficult. Okay, there is a question from Rabia. She's saying, any tips for tax? A, I don't teach tax. B, I do have a tip for tax. That is, read the book. Read the book. Generally speaking, all over the globe, teachers are going to come up with their notes for tax. And students are only going to rely on those notes. Notes are never complete, whether they are developed by world's number one teacher or whosoever. So prepare yourself from the book. If you are good at the book of tax, you are automatically good at everything. Don't rely on the notes, whether it is tax or whether it is advanced tax. You got to read the book. That's the huge tip. That's a huge tip. Okay. Okay, COVID situation in my country. Well, Islamabad is highly vaccinated now. I am in the capital of Pakistan, which is Islamabad. Islamabad is highly vaccinated now, and Islamabad is, I would say, very, very, very safe. But and one particular city is facing problem in Pakistan right now, and that is unfortunately the biggest of all, the most populated city, that is Karachi. So if Karachi could be handled well by the government and the, you know, law enforcement agencies and the paramedic staff, then things will be better. Overall, things are pretty okay in Pakistan. We never had a scary moment, thank God. Okay, haven't you done FR or FA for a few years? Any advice on how to answer risk questions without knowing the IAS rulings? Baba, you got to prepare 6 to 7 accounting standards. And when I say you got to prepare those 6 to 7 accounting standards, that means you got to invest hardly 5 minutes per accounting standard. What are those accounting standards? IAS 1, note them down. IAS 1, IAS 2 inventory, IAS 10 events after reporting period, IAS 16 property plant equipment, IAS 36 impairment, 37 provision, 38 intangible assets, 7 accounting standard. That's it. So this is not a big deal. Okay, hold. Sir, after finish my revise, I feel like I forgot after a few minutes. I don't know whether it is because of stress or something. Okay, this is quite normal. This happens with me as well. So I think I'm normal. So as you, don't worry, chill. In control questions, why auditor identified that customers are not satisfied, etc. In actual, auditor have responsibility to give an opinion on the financial statement. In control questions, why auditor identified that customers are not. Oh, I'm not saying customers are not satisfied. Watch your words. I'm saying if you're not going to overcome this particular deficiency, you will have problems because your customers will be dissatisfied. I am making them realize that this deficiency is important for them so that they can overcome that deficiency. Otherwise, I'm not bothered about their customers. Okay. Mohammed Salman, I am so sorry to hear that. You can get the recordings. Okay. Thank you, guys. Okay. Last suggestion. Any tips for FM? Karthika has asked. For FM, my tip is that normally speaking, the FM teachers, with all due respect, I respect all of them. Normally speaking, the FM teachers are more focused over the long questions. How to calculate NPV, how to calculate the working capital, what's the cost of capital? They're more focused on long questions. So you got to make sure that you on your own are investing quality time on the section A and section B. And you got to invest quality time on the theoretical parts of the section C. That's my tip for FM. Theoretical parts of section C. How much time we need to spend on AA? Well, I just told you at least 2 long questions per day, 6 OTQs, and I think you might want to read book for half an hour daily. So overall, that gives you 4-5 hours per day, at least 3-4 hours per day. How do I know how much right, especially with definitions, is the answers always are overwhelming? And yeah, if you could produce 70% of the past paper answer, you are good at it. Okay, last question for the day, then we are starting the main topic. Last question for the day. The last question is from Diksha, and she's asking the AA changes. There are no major changes whatsoever, no major change. So just chill. Nothing has changed. 99% things remain the same. Okay, here are 4 hours, 5 hours, if not 3 hours, 5 hours. Let's make it 5 hours. Okay, then I'm done with the questions. I'm done. Thank you. And now I'm going to start the main event. Substantive procedures. If you could recall my yesterday's lecture, I told you that there are 2 types of auditor's actions. I told you there are 2 types of audit procedures. A, test of control. What do I mean by test of control? Test of control means auditor will apply a certain action in order to verify whether the controls are operating effectively or not. So we call it test of controls. Now comes the second procedure. The second action of the auditor, it's called substantive procedures. Now, what do I mean by substantive procedures? Substantive procedure is an action performed by the auditor in order to verify whether the financial statements, whether the amounts in the financial statements, whether the corresponding disclosure notes are reflecting a true and fair view or not. So what's the marking scheme for substantive procedure? One substantive procedure will give us one mark, or it is going to yield one mark. So there is one mark per procedure. This exam requirement describes substantive procedures the auditor needs to perform. It is the most important exam requirement we have. Okay. Now the question is, what are substantive procedures? First of all, you got to understand one substantive procedure is going to give us one mark, and substantive procedure is an action performed by the auditor. Watch my words. Substantive procedure is an action performed by the auditor, because the auditor wants to verify the amounts within the financial statements. So the subject matter or the focus is on the financial statements now, not on the control systems. I'm not bothered whether the report was signed. I'm not bothered whether the invoices were sequentially numbered. I'm not bothered whether the purchases were authorized. I'm not bothered whether the bank reconciliation was performed and whether it was reviewed by Mr. X. So I'm not bothered about controls. I'm bothered about the amounts, whether the amounts are correct or not. So let's talk about the substantive procedures. The substantive procedures are divided into many categories, as you can see on your screen. The first type of substantive procedure is called analytical procedures. Now, what do I mean by analytical procedures? Analytical procedures means comparisons, ratio analysis, trend analysis. Maybe you would like to realize that the sales have gone up, but the distribution costs have gone down. And this is not a digestible situation. If the sales have gone up, but the distribution costs have gone down, this is unusual. You got to have a skeptic attitude, and you got to imagine, or you got to think, that how come sales have gone up, but on the contrary, the distribution costs have gone down. Usually the distribution cost is aligned with the sales. So these are called analytical procedures. The second substantive procedure, is called inquiries and confirmations. Let's break them down. Inquiries and confirmation. What are inquiries? Inquiry means, as an auditor, you are going to inquire from the management. You might want to have a discussion with the management. So in the past paper answers, you are going to find wording such as inquire with the management, or you are going to figure out that the past paper answer is suggesting have a discussion with the management regarding the assumptions they have used. So this is inquire and discuss. So the word is inquiries. And who is going to inquire? You, the auditor. And from whom you are going to inquire? The management. Why you want to inquire? Because you want to have their point of view on certain thing. You want to make sure that they are coming up with a solid explanation. You might want to buy their explanation. You might not want to accept their explanation, but at least you want to perform this procedure, this action. And that is, you need to have an inquiry. You need to have a discussion with the client. Okay, let's go to the second part of it. C stands for confirmation, inquiries and confirmations. What do I mean by confirmations? As an auditor, you might want to confirm certain things, but not from the management, but from the third parties. Third parties? What third parties? If I am the auditor and you are my client, your debtors are the third parties. Your payables are the third parties. I'm the auditor, you're the client. Your lawyer is a third party. Your insurance provider is a third party. Your tax authority, such as HMRC, or whatever the tax authority in your country is, that's a third party. So if there is a legal case going on against you, you are my audit client, the lawyer becomes a third party. The party which has made a claim, that becomes a third party. So as an auditor, we might want to confirm certain things, and those certain things will be confirmed from the third parties, and those confirmation are called that confirmation process is called a substantive procedure, and that confirmation which we receive is a source of evidence for us. So we are done with A for analytical procedures, E for inquiries and confirmations. We generally inquire and have a discussion with the management, and normally speaking, we tend to receive confirmation from the third parties. Okay, one exceptional case. Hold on, concentrate. One exceptional case. Sometimes on a very, very, very rare basis, we might want to have confirmation from the management. That sounds tricky. I said we need to inquire and have a discussion with the management, and I said we need to have confirmations from the third parties. But here is an exception. Sometimes on a very, 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 you know, rare basis, once in a blue moon, we might want to have certain confirmations from the management in writing. Those confirmations are called written representations, and those are the confirmations sought by the auditor from the management in writing. Okay, let's continue with this AEIOU. I stands for inspection. Now, what do I mean by inspection? Generally speaking, as an auditor, inspection is a verb, it's an action, it's a substantive procedure, and inspections are performed on two things. I can inspect the tangible asset. I can inspect the tangible asset such as this laptop. I can inspect the air condition. I can inspect the vehicle. I can inspect the plant, the building. I can inspect the inventory, the raw material, the work in progress, the finished goods, and all the tangible assets. I can inspect all the tangible assets. I can't inspect the license you have. I can't inspect that. I can't inspect your intangible assets. But I can inspect the documents as well. So I can inspect the license agreement you have. I can inspect the loan agreement. I can inspect the sales invoice. I can inspect the purchase invoice. So there are two utilities of inspection: A, the tangible assets; B, the documents. So I stands for inspection. I hope it's clear. Let's continue. AEIOU. O stands for observations, and observations are usually used when it comes to test of controls. If you could recall yesterday's lecture, we were trying to observe how the management is performing any XYZ activity. I remember from the last class, there was a test of control, visit the factory, especially at the time of the change of shift, and observe whether all the employees are using their swipe card in order to enter or exit their factory, and more importantly, whether this whole process is supervised by someone responsible. So you got to observe all that thing. So observation. Normally speaking, observations are used as tests of controls rather than substantive procedures. Last thing, U, recalculation. Yes, recalculation starts with R, but in order to complete the mnemonic, it's called U for recalculation. And what's recalculation? If there is a calculation performed by the management, you might want to recalculate everything. You might want to recalculate it just to make sure that there is no arithmetical mistake in it. So it's called recalculation. There is one more thing which is called reperformance. If you want to use your own assumptions as an auditor, if you want to apply your own logics, your own assumptions, your own accounting knowledge, and you want to match your results with the client's result, that's called reperformance. Otherwise, if you are going to get the breakdown of the calculations performed by the client, and if you are going to get the breakdown and just cast them, just make sure that the calculations are accurate. If you are trying to verify the arithmetical accuracy, it's called recalculation. So are you all clear with this AEIOU? Can you please confirm me? Thank you very much. Fantastic. Fantastic. Yes, Nabil, you are absolutely right. When it comes to recalculation, basically you are doing undo of the calculation. You are reperforming the calculation. You just want to make sure that when the calculations were performed by the management, there were no arithmetical mistake in it. Okay, there is one common question from majority of you, that is regarding observation. See, observation is a very difficult procedure when it comes to substantive procedure. Why I'm saying that? Because normally speaking, when you are going to observe, you might not be able to verify the financial statements. But for the sake of, you know, example, and for the sake of convenience, one example could be, you might want to observe the process of, you know, you might want to observe the physical condition of the work in progress. You might want to observe the physical condition of your inventory just to figure it out whether it is damaged or not, whether it is in good condition or not. That could verify the valuation of inventory. So that could be one example. Okay, one last question. Documents are intangible assets, they can be inspected. Why invoices not? I didn't get your question. Documents are not intangible assets, first of all. Documents are documents, and we can either inspect tangible assets or we can inspect the documents. Yes, if you want to verify the intangible assets, you might want to verify the intangible assets through inspecting their documents. Okay, Ali Akbar is saying, please repeat analytical procedures. Analytical procedures are comparisons, analysis, those comparisons which might going to reveal unusual patterns or unusual trends. And those unusual trends or patterns or trends might reveal a potential material misstatement. So imagine if the sales have gone up, but the cost of sales have gone down. What do you think about it? What do you think about it? I think it's something which is unusual, and that might create a doubt in your mind, and you got to verify it. So these are analytical procedures. The examiner is not going to ask us such question because observation can be utilized in either case. But yes, observation is more frequently used when it comes to test of controls. Okay, Sonam has asked, please explain inquiries. Inquiries means you got to have a discussion with the management, and you got to make sure whatever their assumptions are, whatever their logics are, they are reasonable, they are fine, they are acceptable. So inquiry means that you got to have a discussion with the management. It's your fundamental right that you can have a question answer session with the client. That's inquiries. Are you clear? Okay, Mohammed Sabir Azim has asked, is confirmation, we are talking about external confirmations? Yes, because the confirmations can be divided into two categories. Greater majority of the confirmations are external confirmations, such as from the lawyer, from the debt receivable, payable, insurance provider. But there is one exceptional class of confirmation, which is an internal confirmation from the management, and it's called written representation. No, I would say you are not supposed to observe the fixed asset. For the fixed asset, tangible asset, the right word would be inspection. You've got to inspect the tangible asset. Please explain inquiries. Inquiry means you got to have a discussion with the management. But if you are going to have a discussion with the third party, that's a confirmation. That's different. Usually you don't have discussions with the third parties, right? Is re-performance a substantive procedure? Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes, we can observe the inventory count procedures. So thank you, Mohammed Salman. Yes, we can observe the inventory count process. That is how we will be able to confirm the valuation of inventory. So the observation could be used as a substantive procedure. Well done. Okay, I think that's it. You all are done with the questions. Can I explain re-performance? Yes, if I am going to make sure that when you were calculating goodwill, you did not made any arithmetical mistake, that is called recalculation. But if I am going to use my own fair values, I'm going to use my own assumptions, and I'm going to develop my own calculation of goodwill, and I'm going to match it with the client's calculation, that is called re-performance. Okay, Manur is asking, inspection can be done on the documents of intangible assets. Yes, So don't focus on the intangible assets, focus on the intangible, focus on the documents. So inspection can be used for the tangible assets and for the documents. Thank you, Manu. Okay, done. I think we need to continue now. Okay, so these were the substantive procedures A, E, I, O, U. If they are not making sense to you right now, don't worry, it will take time. I haven't connected things as yet, so it will take time. Now, why do we apply substantive procedures? Why do we need to apply substantive procedures? I'm asking you, why do we need to apply substantive procedures? What's bothering you? What's your target? What's your agenda? Why do you need to apply substantive procedures? Please answer. Okay, together answer, to gather evidence, to confirm assertions, to detect material misstatements, to calculate the trend of change, risk assessment, to confirm, not risk assessment, due to weak controls, yeah, kind of. Okay, fine. Yes, whether the financial statements are giving a true and fair view or not, Furkan, you are right. Yes, Somia, you are right to check if there are any errors in the financial statements. Yes, Akbar, you are right to verify the amounts in the financial statements. Well done. Yes, Alima, you are absolutely right to ensure that to verify the integrity of the financial statements, to ensure the numbers. Yes, Adil, all of you are right. Well done. Okay, now listen to me. So there is a set of financial statements in front of you, and you are the external auditor, and you are supposed to apply substantive procedures. Why? Because the client or the management have prepared those financial statements, and now they are claiming certain things. The management is claiming certain things, and those claims in the language of audit are called assertions. What do I mean by assertions? Assertion means the certain claims made by the management. Management is going to claim that the financial statements are giving a true and fair view. What does that mean? Management is going to claim that all the assets which we have recognized in the statement of financial position, they do exist. So we have not recorded any fake asset. So the management is going to claim that all the assets which we have recognized, they do exist. What does that mean? Which means that they are claiming that there is no fake asset in it. So it's called existence. Management is going to claim that all the assets which we have recorded in the financial statements, to be precise, in the statement of financial position, they are at appropriate value. We have not overstated them. Obviously, we have not understated them either. Management is going to claim that we have not omitted or missed out any liability. So the management is going to claim, that we have not missed anything out. It's called completion. The management is going to claim that all the assets are, we have got rights on all the assets which we have recognized, and all the liabilities which we have recognized in the statement of financial position are the obligations of the company. So as far as statement of financial position is concerned, the management is going to claim few things, and those few things are EVCR. First E, the E stands for existence. What do I mean by existence? Existence means all the assets, all the liabilities, and all the capital which we have recognized in the statement of financial position, it exists for real. Nothing is fake. Nothing is falsified. Everything exists. So what do I mean by existence? If I'm recognizing four vehicles, it means I do have four vehicles with me. If I'm recognizing five vehicles, and as a matter of fact, we have got only four vehicles, the fifth vehicle does not exist. So existence means all those assets, liabilities, and capital which the company or the client is recognizing in the statement of financial position, they exist for real. So this is the first assertion, and this assertion belongs to the statement of financial position. The second assertion is called valuation. Let's imagine I have recognized four vehicles, and I do have four vehicles. So existence is all right. Let's assume that there is no tension about the existence. Now, what if out of those four vehicles, one of them is significantly damaged in a recent accident, and as a result, that particular vehicle is significantly impaired, but I have not charged the impairment expense. I have not written off that particular non-current asset. I have not written off the value of that particular vehicle. So what do you say now? Are those four vehicles valued at the correct amount? I really don't think so, because three of them are all right, but one of them has been significantly damaged. And as a result, the valuation of that fourth vehicle is not up to the mark. So this is called valuation. The management is going to claim that all the vehicles, or for that matter, all the liabilities, all the assets, or all the capital is valued or recognized in the statement of financial position at the correct value. It's called valuation. Okay, now what about the completeness? Just imagine there are three legal cases going on against my client, and the client has recognized provision against two of the claims, but the client has intentionally or unintentionally omitted one of them, one out of the three. The client has omitted one out of the three. So now you tell me, those two liabilities, those two provisions which the client has recognized, do they exist? Yes, they exist. Their valuations are all right. Their valuations are correct. Yes, both those two provisions are valued at correct amount. So the valuation is all right. Now the burning question, please concentrate. Whether the provisions are complete. Are they complete? Are the liabilities complete? No, they are not complete, because three provisions should have been incorporated, but the client has incorporated only two. So yes, those two exist. Yes, those two are correctly valued, but they are not complete, because there had to be another one, but the client has omitted it. It's called completeness. What is the claim that would be made by the management? The assertion. The management is going to claim, sir, the provisions are complete. We haven't missed anything out. So this is called completeness. The last assertion is called rights and obligations. And in order to make it convenient for you, in order to make it more simpler for you, you could say rights and obligation can be transformed into one word, that is ownership. All the assets recognized by the management should be the ownership of the management. All the liabilities recognized by the management should be the ownership of the management. Are you going to recognize a liability in your statement of financial position which is not your obligation? I think the answer is no. Are you allowed to recognize an asset in your statement of financial position which you do not own, which you are not having any rights on it? The answer should be no. So rights and obligation. So imagine there is a non-current asset here. So it exists, and it is correctly valued in the statement of financial position. So valuation is all right, and it's recorded in the non-current asset register. So the completeness is not an issue here. What if this is not your non-current asset? What if you have just got it on rent? What if you are going to return it day after tomorrow? So do you have any rights on that particular asset? The answer is no. And as a result, you cannot and you should not recognize that asset, because you do not have any rights, or you do not own it, and the definition of asset does not meet. So these are the assertions or the claims made by the management regarding the statement of financial position. Is this clear? If there is any question regarding this EVCR, please go on. Okay, Mr. Ali Akbar has asked, can you please repeat completeness? Yes, if there are five liabilities and you are, as a management, you are recording four out of five, your statement of financial position, or for that matter, your liabilities are not complete. Well done. Are you clear, Ali? Mohammed Salman has asked, sir, are performed to where? Substantive procedures are performed to verify values and assertions. Am I right? You are absolutely right, my friend. You are dead right. We also test cutoff for inventory. I am going to discuss cutoff in a short while when I am going to discuss the other part of the assertions. So hang on. Does substantive procedures over form concept relate to rights and obligations? Yeah, kind of the substance over form concept. Okay. Confusing with C and R. I didn't get it. What's C and completeness and rights? Existence is for tangible things. Yes, existence is for tangible things. Okay, the next part of the assertions, the other part of the statement, financial statements, which is called the profit or loss account. As far as the profit or loss account is concerned, again, the management is going to claim certain things. And as an auditor, we need to remain skeptic. We need to maintain professional skepticism. We need to verify those assertions. We are not going to believe their unquestioned honesty. Now, what are the claims made by the management regarding the statement of profit or loss account? Those could be divided into another mnemonic called COCA, COCCA. The first C stands for completeness. Now, what do I mean by completeness? Let's imagine I am the management and the cost of sales amount is 100,000. What if I have intentionally or unintentionally omitted 10,000? What if the amount should have been 110,000, but I have recognized it 100,000. So all the revenues, all the expenses should be recorded, which needs to be recorded. So what do I mean by completeness? That everything which required the recognition have been recorded by the management. That's what completeness means. Generally speaking, management does not omit anything out of revenue. Generally speaking, revenue is complete. But when it comes to expenses, there is a huge possibility that certain things are omitted. That is, they are not complete. Okay, second assertion is called occurrence. What if the management has recognized 5 transactions on the last day with respect to revenue? The management has recognized 5 transactions with respect to sales, with respect to revenue on the last day of the accounting period. What if out of those 5, 4 never happened? 4 were fake. One was real. So you have recognized all 5 as revenue. Is your revenue actually occurred? No, it never occurred. One occurred, but 4 never occurred. So what do I mean by occurrence? That all those transactions, all those sales, all those expenses which you have recognized in the profit or loss account should have occurred. They should not be fake. If you could realize, occurrence is more or less same like existence. Existence means those assets or those liabilities should exist at the balance sheet date, because statement of financial position is prepared for a particular date as at. But for occurrence means those transactions should have occurred anytime but within that particular accounting period. Occurrence. Okay, now the third assertion, cut off. Now imagine there were 2 sales on the last day of the accounting period and 5 sales on the next day of the accounting period, but the client has recognized all 7. The client has recognized all 7. So completeness is not an issue because client has recognized everything. Occurrence is not an issue because all those 7 transactions actually occurred. But now the burning question is, are you allowed to recognize all 7, considering 2 occurred, 2 happened to be within the accounting period, but the next 5 happened after the accounting period? Let's say 2 good dispatch notes were generated and the goods were transferred to the customer within the accounting period, and 5 good dispatch notes were issued and 5 goods were transferred to the customer after the accounting period, the next day, the next week. If the client is going to recognize all 7, this is going to create a material misstatement or simply a misstatement in the financial statement. And that misstatement has got to do with an assertion, a wrong claim, a falsified claim made by the management. And that false claim has got to do with cutoff. Now, what do I mean by cutoff? Cutoff means that things should be recognized in the correct accounting period. This is called cutoff. Second last assertion is called classification. Classification means the cost of sales should be recognized in the cost of sales. The other expenses should be recognized in the other expenses. You need to split them up correctly. You need to make, if somebody is going to recognize a portion of cost of sales into expenses, at the end of the day, the net profit will be the same or the net profit will be accurate, but this is not a proper classification. What about the last assertion, accuracy? Accuracy is more or less like valuation. What does valuation means? All the assets, liabilities and capital should be valued at the correct amount. And with the similar logic, what does accuracy means? All the sales, the expenses, the profits, which you have recognized in the profit and loss account should be valued at the correct value, the accurate amount. So this is called accuracy. EVCR, COCA, are you clear with these assertions? If you are clear, I can go on. Hira has asked, what's the difference between classification and valuation? Isn't it both about right treatment according to standards? Yeah, more or less it is like this. Clear, Saifur Rahman is clear, Sarosh is clear, Ajwa is clear, Neha is very clear. And can I have at least 20 more? Yes, so that I can move on with more confidence. Okay, Alima is clear, Aska is clear, Varda is clear, Rabia is clear, Nabil is clear, Gautam is clear. Okay, Angelina is clear. Hold on. Sahar is saying accuracy and completeness almost the same. If things are not complete, it means the client has omitted something. But whatever they have recognized, if that is not overvalued or undervalued, that has got to do with accuracy. So there is a difference. Accuracy means whatever you have recognized, it should be correct. Completed means you need to recognize everything which needs recognition. So Mupapi is saying crystal clear, and I love it, crystal clear. Okay, good classification work for SOFP. Yes, if you are going to recognize a non-current asset as a current asset or vice versa, if you are going to recognize a current liability as a non-current liability or vice versa, the classification works for the statement of financial position as well. Thank you, Don. Abdulahad, I've answered your question and you're absolutely right, Abdulahad. You're absolutely right. Akbar is clear. Stephen, please add me to the group. Stephen, you will be added. Don't worry. Somebody is going to share the link with you. And if somebody is not going to share the link with you, you can contact me directly and I'll add you up. Don't worry. Don't worry about the WhatsApp group. Furkan, classification can be used. Stephen, I will share. Yes, the number has been shared with you. You need to text me up after the class. Don't do it right now. Don't use your cell phone. Hey, hello everyone. Please don't use your cell phone. Okay, everyone is crystal clear. Thanks God. Okay, let's move on. Good, Sarah, good. If you are taking class on cell phone, that is not an ideal situation. Trust me, this is not recommended. You should have taken the class on a laptop or computer. Ashir, I got you. I knew it. I'm just wondering what Zulkarnain and Heather might be doing right now. Okay, sir, there is a question from Furkan. Hold. Sir, if asset is sold after the year end and recorded in this year, is not it cutoff error? If the asset is sold after the year end, so at the balance sheet date, at the statement of financial position date, that asset was with you. So you still need to recognize that asset within your year end statement of financial position. No problem. Okay, Rabia is saying social media is unstalled. That's a fantastic approach. At least for last 20 odd days, everyone needs to get rid of this social media thing. Okay, Barbara has asked, sir, please repeat completeness under SOFP. If there are 5 liabilities recorded by the management, but they should have recorded 6. So their assertion regarding the completeness with respect to SOFP is not right. That's what an auditor will be thinking. What does completeness means? the management is claiming that we have recorded all the liabilities. We haven't omitted anything. That's what completeness means. Is this clear now? No, Neha. Thank you, Barbara. Okay, Salman. Okay, Akbar. Okay, let's go. Okay, let me show you the question. Wait. Okay, now, so far what we have covered, that there are assertions called, there are substantive procedures called AEIOU, and there are assertions which we need to verify, which are called EVCR, COCA. Now, how do we get the evidence? All of you told me that you guys need to perform substantive procedures in order to get evidence, right? That's what you said. So all of us needs to perform substantive procedures in order to verify assertions. But the burning question is, from where we are going to get the evidence? We are going to get evidence from this particular mnemonic, which is called DADA3, or you could say DADA3. Now, what's DADA3? The first D stands for directors. As an auditor, are you going to inquire with the directors? Are you going to have discussion with the directors? Are you interested in the point of view of the directors? If the answer is yes, so directors are a possible source of evidence for you. Let's talk about the second source of evidence, as assets. Are you going to inspect the tangible non-current asset? Are you going to visit and inspect the factory? Are you going to visit and inspect the land the company has recently purchased? Are you going to inspect the inventory in order to verify the physical condition, and moreover, in order to verify the NRV? Are you going to inspect the plant in order to figure out whether it has been damaged due to flood or not? So are you going to inspect assets? The answer is yes. So it means asset is a source of evidence. Are you going to inspect the purchase agreement in order to verify the amount of the purchase? Are you going to inspect the loan agreement in order to verify whether the client has correctly accounted for the current liability and the non-current liability? Because you will be able to verify the split of the liabilities by inspecting the loan agreement. Are you interested in inspecting the license agreement in order to verify the useful life of a particular software, a patent, any intangible asset? Are you going to review the accounting books and records? Are you interested in sales day book? Are you going to select a sample from the sales day book? Are you going to select a sample from the good dispatch notes? So are you interested in accounting books and records? Are you interested in documents? Are you interested as an auditor in third parties such as bank, lawyer, debtor, payables, insurance provider, the tax authorities? So these are all sources of evidence, and I remember these source of evidence with the help of a mnemonic, and the mnemonic is called DADA3. Is this clear? If it is clear, the summary, the last punchline, the last knockout punch. All of us needs to apply and perform AEIOU. That is the substantive procedures. On DADA3, we are going to apply our procedures on the source of evidence, that is DADA3, because all of us wants to verify the EVCR or the COCA. And overall, this will earn 1 mark, which is 1 mark per substantive procedure. Is this clear to everyone now? Can I have a confirmation? Okay, everyone is absolutely clear. That is fantastic. Mohammed Sabir has asked, out of DADA3, in which will we classify lease schedules? Lease schedules? If you are talking about the amount recognized in the lease by the client, or the amount recognized in the statement, I think you might be interested in the documents, lease documents. Yes, Akbar. The agreement, lease agreement. Or maybe you are interested in the calculation, you might be interested in the accounting books and records. That's the part of the calculation. Maybe you would like to have a maybe you would like to contact the lease provider, that is the third party. So there are many sources of evidence. Is this clear to everyone? Okay, Harsher amortization schedule. Yes, we can recalculate that as well. Okay, I think everyone is clear and it's time to start a question. And before I start any question, before I move on to the question, let me help you out with respect to these standard procedures. Let's start from the most easiest one. Statement of financial position, and on top of statement of financial position, let's talk about non-current assets. Yes, we can inquire directors. Yes, we can review the minutes of the meetings. Yes, we can do everything. Yes, Manasa, you are right. Sayyid Umair Abbas saying, can we take a break before we start a question? Umair, it's 8:15 right now. I might start a long question, a past paper question on at 8:30. So I'll have a break at 8:30. I'll have a 10 minutes break at 8:30. But for now, I need 10 to 15 more minutes before I start the long question. Okay. Okay. Today I'm trying to be as much slow as I can intentionally. Oh, well, break at 8:30, 8:45 doesn't make a huge difference. Come on, come on, come on. Okay, I want to have a discussion regarding substantive procedure. Okay, Sarosh. And I want to have a discussion on substantive procedures, and I want to start with, let's say, non-current assets. Okay, I am the auditor of XYZ company and I have been assigned to apply substantive procedures, and I need to verify, I need to apply substantive procedures on non-current assets. And let's make it simple, tangible non-current assets. Not, let's ignore intangible non-current assets. Let's focus on tangible non-current assets. The first thing which comes in my mind is that I need to apply AEIOU. Hooray. That's the first step. That should be in my mind. Once someone has asked me to apply a substantive procedure, the first thing that should come in my mind should be AEIOU. The next big thing which comes in my mind now, I need to verify, I need to apply substantive procedures. What assertions do they have regarding the tangible non-current assets? What assertions do the client have regarding the tangible non-current assets? The assertions are EVCR. Yes, the valuation and the existence, the rights and the completeness. Usually assets are complete. You are Salman, absolutely right. Usually the assets are complete. Usually the management does not wish to omit any asset. They want to add extra asset. You're right. Well done. Yes, Rabia. Mainly existence. You're right. Mainly Rabia, existence and valuation, because the assets might be overstated. That is a valuation related problem. Yes. Yes, depreciation. Okay, fine. Now what? I want to verify the existence, valuation, completeness, and rights and obligations, EVCR. Okay, let's start from the existence. How can I verify the existence of non-current assets? Let's say the vehicle, let's say the plant. I will select a sample of non-current assets from the non-current asset register. Yes, Maaz Afridi. Yes, Bupapi. Yes, you're right. I'm sorry. Yes, you're right. Yes, Sara, you're absolutely right. So I'm going to select a sample of tangible non-current asset from the non-current asset register, from the accounting books, accounting records. Because I have selected the sample from the non-current asset register, it means they are already recorded. They have already been recorded. So I'm not trying to verify completeness here because they've already recorded. After selecting that sample, I'm going to make sure all these non-current assets are physically present at their allocated location. So I'm going to inspect those assets according to the sample, and this will verify the existence. Just imagine there was an asset which I selected from the sample and it's not there. It means the asset has been recorded, but the asset does not actually or physically exist. Maybe it has been stolen. Maybe it was never there. I don't know. So through this, or maybe yes, you're right, it's a fictitious asset. So that is how you are going to verify the existence of the non-current asset. Select a sample of non-current asset from the non-current asset register and trace them. Make sure they are physically available and physically inspect them. This is how you are going to verify the existence. Let's verify the opposite of existence, that is completion. How can I verify the completion? Okay, wait. I'm sitting in a room and I can see an air condition over there. So an air condition is there. I can see that. And this is the premises I need to audit. This is my client. If the air condition is here and I can see it, it means that particular asset does exist. So I need to select a sample of air conditions from the premises of the client. And because I'm selecting the sample from the physical premises, I can see them all. They all exist. Now I'm not trying to verify existence here. I'm going to trace them. I'm going to make sure all these assets are incorporated or included within the non-current asset register. And this is how I'm going to verify the completeness, because if that asset is over there, or if that air condition is over there, if these assets have been, I can see them, they are there. So it means they should have been recognized in the non-current asset register. And that is how I'm going to verify the completeness. Is this clear? Completeness and existence. Let's talk about the most tricky part. Thank you. If it is clear to you, it's fantastic. Let's talk about the valuation, the examiner's favorite part. No, the valuation of non-current asset is the examiner's most favorite part. How can I verify the valuation of non-current assets? First of all, if this is a new non-current asset which you have purchased, this air condition during the year, I would like to inspect the purchase invoice. And I would like to verify the amount stated in it. And that is how I can verify the valuation of it. Yes, the same amount can be verified from the purchase invoice to the bank statement, whether the same amount was paid by the client to the supplier. Yes, you are right. The valuation has got to do with the carrying values of the non-current assets. And Sarosh, you are right. The carrying values have got to do with the estimates of the useful life, the depreciation. So you might want to recalculate the depreciation and make sure that the carrying values or the net book values are correct. And that is how you are going to verify the valuation. You might want to make sure that the estimates regarding the useful life made by the management are reasonable. So you might want to have a discussion and you might want to inquire with the management what assumptions do they have used regarding the useful lives and whether those assumptions are reasonable. Yes, that's why I'm giving another example. I hope it's clear now. So in order to verify valuation, A, invoices, B, depreciation, recalculation of the depreciation expense, C, you might want to have a discussion with the management regarding the useful lives. Select a sample of asset, compare it with similar assets in the industry. Yes, we can compare the valuation of this particular client with the similar assets of the industry or the competitor, and that is how you are going to verify the valuation. If that particular asset is a tricky one, and as an auditor, you are not that familiar and that confident, you might want to engage on a very exceptional cases. You might want to engage an expert, and that expert could help you in valuing that particular assets. Yes, Asher, yes, Akbar, an independent valuer can be involved. Yes, you can write more than one substantive procedure for a particular assertion. If the examiner has not asked you to be specific, you could choose on your own. Sarosh is saying, can we confirm it from the seller? If it's a commodity, if it is something which is readily available in the market, you might want to check the market rate of that particular asset. And in this way, you can check out the valuation of that particular asset as well. Manur is saying, should depreciation be recalculated in order to verify the carrying value of the asset? Manur, you are absolutely right. Neha is saying, sir, we are given with lots of substantive procedures under each assertion, right? So do we need to learn them by heart? Neha, hold on. Neha, you're not supposed to learn them by heart without any concept or logic. But with the passage of time, with the practice, if certain procedure comes into your mind out of nowhere, and if you could say that I know these things in any way on any given day, yeah, you are fine with it. But don't directly cram them, don't directly learn them without logic. You got to understand them first. It's been more than 1 hour and I'm trying to make you understand things. But with the passage of time, with the practice, you will be able to understand few things. Okay, one last procedure for valuation. One of my personal favorite. Thank you, Neha. Okay, one of my personal favorite. Okay, listen to me now. The client has recognized tangible non-current asset in the statement of financial position, and the amount which the client has recognized is let's say $2.4 million. Now you tell me whether this $2.4 million is about one particular asset or it's about multiple tangible non-current assets. You tell me. Yes, Sara, multiple, Waleed, multiple, Jazeb, multiple, yes, multiple, yes, Mushna, multiple. So what we should do, what can we do? We are going to get the breakdown of that 2.4 million from the client and we are going to cast it. We are going to add them up. Yes, we are going to get the breakdown and then cast it. I need to make sure that the opening balance was correct from the last year's closing balance. Then they added certain things, that they dispose of certain things. I just want to make sure that their arithmetical, you know, additions, their arithmetical accuracy is all right. I just want to make sure that there is no arithmetical mistake in it. So once you are going to get the breakdown and you are going to cast it, you are going to get the schedule of it, you are going to get the breakdown of it, and you are going to cast it, you are going to recalculate it. This is how you could verify the valuation. Is this clear to everyone? Can I have a yes, please? Okay, Somya has asked about the completeness. If the client has recognized 5 assets, but the client has got 6 assets, it means the client is not following the assertion called completeness. They should have recognized all 6. What does completeness means? They need to recognize all the assets. So what about completeness in the context of non-current asset? Yes, Sarah, it is going to verify. No, it is going to verify valuation. The word accuracy is for the profit or loss account, Sarah. Don't use accuracy word for the tangible non-current asset. The word accuracy is used for the, okay. Yes, Akbar. Okay, if you want to verify the completeness of non-current assets, what do you have to do? All those non-current assets which you can see are present over here, they should be part of the non-current asset register, right? So select a sample of non-current assets physically available and then trace them and make sure they are part of the non-current asset register. This is how you verify completeness. Okay, one last question from Vidisha. Can you please repeat the last point on valuation, the one which is my favorite? You got to get the breakdown of the tangible non-current assets because the client must have recognized a huge amount on the face of the financial statement, which is, let's say, 2.4 million. Get the breakdown of that 2.4 million from the client. Cast them, add them up, recalculate them. Make sure they have not performed any arithmetical mistake in it. Is this clear, Vidisha? So that was me trying to explain few things about tangible non-current assets. Let me talk about provisions now. Let me talk about liabilities, and in the context of liabilities, let's talk about provisions. What comes in your mind when I say apply the substantive procedures on provisions? I think the first thing which comes into your mind is provision is part of the current liability, which means we need to verify EVCR. So first thing which comes in your mind is EVCR and AEIOU. Okay, what can you do for the sake of provisions? Now the question is, what kind of provisions? Let's say the provisions are for the warranty claims made by the customers. Provisions for the warranty claims made by the management. Okay, hold on. I'm a student and I'm attempting a past paper question, or I'm attempting my final exam on 6 September. I've been asked to apply substantive procedures on the warranty claims made by the customers against the faulty goods. Okay, I'm totally blank right now. My teacher told me to apply AEIOU. What's A? What's A? Comparisons, analytical procedures comparison. Can I compare this year's provision with the last year's provision? And if there is any significant fluctuation in the this year provision, if there is any significant fluctuation, can I have a discussion with the management about it? Can I further investigate it? Does that sound a valid procedure? Hold on to your procedure. Hold on to your procedure. Just tell me, am I thinking all right? AEIOU, A stands for analytical procedures. Can I compare this year's provisions for the warranty claims with the last year, specifically on a month by month basis? And if there is any significant fluctuation, can I have a discussion with the management why there is a significant fluctuation, and I need to verify whether their explanation is sensible, reasonable or not. So that's A. Now I'm a student and I'm attempting my paper and I'm totally blank. The examiner has asked me to apply substantive procedures on provisions. I'm done with A. Now E, inquire. Can I inquire something with the management? Can I discuss something with the management? Inquire. What did my teacher tell? My teacher told me you can have discussion with the management. Can I have a discussion? Yeah, I can have a discussion. Inquire with the management what assumptions they have used when they were establishing this year's provisions against the warranty claims, and make sure those assumptions are reasonable under the given circumstances. Maybe the client has significantly reduced the provisions against the warranty claims, and maybe the client is not wrong. Maybe this year they have improved their quality control, maybe they have come up with better raw material, maybe they are right about it. So you need to inquire with the management what assumptions they have used when they were formulating the provisions, and whether those assumptions are reasonable. Am I going in the right direction? Okay, A, I'm done with A, I'm done with E. What about C, confirmations. Can I contact the lawyer and can I confirm what level of claims are they getting from the customers regarding the warranty claims, and whether those claims are in line with the provision calculated by the management? Yes, the pattern. Yes, Rabia, you're right. The claim pattern. Yes, I can verify that from the lawyer, because maybe the lawyer handles that issue. So that's a third party evidence confirmation. Okay, AEIOU. Can I inspect anything? Yes, I would like to inspect the correspondence between the customers and my client in order to verify what level of customers or what percentage of customers are dissatisfied, and in this way I will be able to verify whether the provisions are up to the mark or not. Thank you very much, dear students. I'm loving it. You all are suggesting me that I need to inspect the claim documents, and some of you are suggesting I need to review the minutes of the meetings. Yes, Akbar. Yes, Salman. I need to review the board minutes of the meeting in order to verify what level of claim they are expecting, what level of claim they are facing. Are they in a spot of bother? Are they tense? Are they confident? By reviewing the minutes of the meetings, I will be able to judge that whether the claims, whether the provision recognized by the management is up to the mark or is it understated. Yes, AEIIO, observe, forget observation, recalculation. Can I inspect post year end payments? I just gave you a hint. Okay, Hashir, hold on. I will come back with the word correspondence. Okay, now tell me, what focus on my question. Please focus on my question. Can I inspect post year end payments? I just gave you a hint. What does that mean? Why I'm interested in post year end compensation payments? Why I'm interested in that? Inspect the post year end payments. No, Mayor, I'm not interested in because of the cutoff. No. Yes, Rabia, you're right. Yes, Sarosh, you are right. Yes, Akbar, you're right. Yes, Gautam. No, Gautam, I'm not going for the going concern right now. I would like to inspect the post year end payments made by my client for the warranty claims or in the context of warranty claims in order to make sure whether those actual payments made by the client are in line with the provision recorded. Just imagine the client has made actual payments of 0.5 million, but their provision is 0.1 million. Now, what do you say? The actual payments are around 0.5 million after the year end, but the year end provision was just 0.1 million. Now, what do you say? Yes, O'Brien, you're right. Yes, Gautam, now you are clear. Very good. Yes, Asong, fantastic. To compare what was paid and what was the provision. Yes, in order to verify whether the provision was understated. Fantastic. Well done, well done, well done. Okay, okay, hold, now hold, now hold. Can I seek management representation from the management? Can I get confirmation in writing from the management that their judgment and their provision is up to the mark and they have not missed anything out? Can I ask the management to give me this in writing? Because this is judgmental and only management knows the truth. Can I ask them to give me an evidence in writing? Yes, this is another valid procedure. Exactly, I can. Thank you. Okay, one last. Management must have recognized the provision as a current liability in the statement of financial position. What accounting standard is that? IAS 37. Now the question is whether IAS 37 requires a disclosure of it. My question is yes. So I can review the disclosure notes in order to verify the whole situation has been fully disclosed by the client in the disclosure notes. Is this clear now? Yes, written representation, Jazib, you're absolutely right, are not gathered in every case. They are only gathered when the evidence is only restricted in the mind of the management or it's a very judgmental matter relevant to management. You're absolutely right. Yes, disclosure note in accordance to IAS 37, Akbar, you're absolutely right. Okay, hold on. One last thing. I was supposed to explain the correspondence terminology. What do I mean by correspondence? Correspondence means the discussion between the management and, let's say in my example, the customers. So if the customers are claiming warranty claims, the discussion or the negotiations and the, you know, the emails or the claims or the letters, whatever it is going on, or the WhatsApp chat maybe, whatever it is going on between my client and their customer, it is called correspondence. Yeah, thank you very much for the good word, conversation. That word conversation is a good word. So I am interested in that communication, in that conversation, because I want to realize what's going on, how things are shaping up, who's cooking, what's the negotiations going on. Yes, Sarosh, yes. So is this clear, the correspondence? Why are you interested in correspondence? Because that might reveal a thing or two. Asher, is this clear to you? So you were saying something about accuracy in tangible non-current asset. Can you please repeat it? I don't remember what I was saying at that point of time. I've got a memory problem, short-term memory loss problem. Thank you very much, Asher. If it's clear to you, I'm loving it. Okay, so that was about the provisions. Confirmation letter, which I'm going to ask from the management, it's called written representation appeal, and I'm going to ask them to pen me down or write me what provision you have recognized. Write me down, is it, it's complete, and the assumptions you have used, write them down as well. So it's a complete statement. Okay, one last thing. Let's move to the one last thing before we move on to the break and then the questions. One last thing. Substantive procedures on, let's say, revenue. And by the way, revenue has got a huge connection with the receivables. Similarly, purchases has got a huge connection with the payables. So let's talk about revenue. What assumptions do we have regarding revenue? Revenue is part of the profit or loss account. So the assertions are COCA, completeness, occurrence, classification, cutoff. So let's talk about completeness and occurrence. They are the opposite of each other. If you are going to select a sample of good dispatch notes, you got to trace them, follow them, make sure all those good dispatch notes are recognized in the sales. The invoices are there and they have been recognized in the sales ledger or the sales day book. That is how you are going to verify completeness. Considering the good dispatch note is there, the transaction actually occurred, all you need to verify that they have been recorded. So that is how you are going to verify completeness. But if you are going to select a sample from the sales day book and you are going to trace the sales invoice and then eventually you are going to verify the good dispatch note, that is how you are going to verify the transaction was not fake, it was a real one, and that is how you are going to verify the occurrence. You got to select a sample of good dispatch note before the year end and after the year end. And then you got to trace all of them. Make sure all those good dispatch notes relevant to before the year end are part of the sales day book. And all those good dispatch notes which were after the year end are not part of the sales day book. That is how you are going to verify cutoff. So cutoff, completeness. How can you verify the accuracy of the revenue? Maybe you would like to inspect the sales invoices and make sure that the same amount is recognized in the sales report. Maybe you would like to verify through the bank statements. Is this clear? Maybe, let's talk about AEIOU. Can you compare anything? Yes, you can compare the revenue of this particular year with the last year, particularly on a month by month basis. And if there is any significant fluctuation, especially at the end of the accounting year, you got to have a discussion with the management. AEIOU, can you inquire with management? Can you recalculate? Can you confirm anything from the third party? Yes, for the sake of revenue, you can directly contact the customer and you can confirm whether that particular transaction happened or not. Can you recalculate anything? Yes, you can get the breakdown of the year-end revenue and cost it and add them up just to make sure that there is no arithmetical mistake in it. Make sure the same amount is there. Is this clear to everyone? Can I have yes? Yes, I can check it out. How much revenue the client has, you know, increased and what's the industry average? Yes, you can compare it with the industry average. Yes, you're right. Okay, thank you, Soumya. Thank you. Okay, then. Okay, O'Brien. Thank you, very clear. Thank you, Akbar. It depends on the question. It depends on the question. Please give me some time. Once I'm done with proper questions, then I might be able to answer your question in a more efficient way. Hold on. Okay, Ajwa is asking, can you please explain cutoff again? Cutoff means that the transactions should be recorded in the correct accounting period. So if the good dispatch note belongs to this particular year, it means the risk and rewards, the economic benefits have been transferred. So you got to recognize that particular revenue at the year end. But if that particular good dispatch note is not does not belong to this particular year, it's the date of that good dispatch note is from the next accounting period, you are not supposed to recognize the relevant revenue because that does not belong to this particular year. Sir, please repeat occurrence of revenue. I want to verify the occurrence, right? So please explain occurrence. And Jelena and Sarosh both are asking the same question. Okay. If I'm going to select a sample from the good dispatch note, it means that particular transaction actually occurred because I'm going to select the sample from the good dispatch note. I'm going to trace them and I'm going to make sure whether they have been recorded in the sales day book. This is the procedure for completeness. But if certain things are recorded in the sales day book, it means completeness is not an issue. I'm going to select a sample from the sales day book and verify the corresponding invoice and verify the corresponding good dispatch note. Now, if the good dispatch note is there, it means it actually occurred. Now I'm relieved that the transaction is not fake. That is how you're going to verify occurrence. Is this clear? Yes, Umair Bas, you are absolutely right. Yes, occurrence means what is returned should have occurred. It should not be fake. Yes, you can make it vice versa. Clear. Okay, Ajwa. Okay, Rabia. Fantastic. Let's, I think it's 8:40 now. Let's have a break of 10 minutes. After 10 minutes, I bet you cannot afford to go away after the break because something very serious is coming to your way. I will be doing at least 2-3 questions on substantive procedures, gooseberry, insects for you, and certain parts of day one and day two were missing as well. So hang on, there is a break for 10 minutes, okay? According to my clock, it's 8:40 now, and I will start teaching at 8:50. So see you after exact 10 minutes. Thank you very much. Sonam, I didn't get your question. I couldn't understand. Soumya, not the subsequent, the substantive. The substantive, yes. Whenever you are performing substantive procedures, you got to think about AEIOU. You got to think about assertions, EVCR or COCA. If you are still running short of ideas, you got to think about data 3. Oh, whether I've discussed, I had a discussion with the director, is something like that. So these things will help you out. Okay, guys, thank you. See you after 9 minutes. Hello, everyone. Receivable circularization letter confirms the, more importantly, it confirms the existence of receivable. If I'm going to write letters to my client's debtor, it's called receivable circularization. And with the help of receivable circularization, I will be able to verify, more importantly, the existence of receivable. Then comes the evaluation. Valuation cannot be verified exactly. Why? Because there is a possibility that receivable might never pay. So more importantly, the existence of the valuation. Okay, hello everyone, and hi everyone. Okay, there is a procedure: obtain trade receivable aging to compare with the last year trade receivable aging in order to review any significant differences. Yeah, kind of. All right. Okay then. Okay, let's go to the question now. Hello. Okay, if you remember, we did a question called Harlem, a risk-based question, on the day one of the webinar. And if you did not attend the day one of the webinar, no problem, because we are not discussing audit risk right now. We are not discussing how, what's the marking scheme of audit risk and what's the marking scheme of audit risk. I'm not going to tell you that the description of a audit risk consists of one mark, the identification gives you half mark, and the explanation gives you half mark, which financial statement item understated, overstated, and why you think that the client's accounting treatment is wrong or could be wrong, and the auditor's response has to be in accordance with the audit risk. So I'm not going to tell you all that. Okay, then what? Let's go to the part C, which we skipped on the other day. Using the information provide, describe the substantive procedure the auditor should perform to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence in relation to the. Every exam question has this same wording. Describe the substantive procedures. And we all know one substantive procedure will give us one mark. We all know the substantive procedures are always applied by the auditor. The auditor should perform, why? To obtain what? The sufficient appropriate evidence in relation to the. In relation to the valuation of trade receivables in the current year. So you need to come up with three procedures, and all those three procedures have got to do with one assertion only, and that assertion is valuation. Is this clear? The requirement. Now, how can I verify the valuation of receivables? AEIOU. There are multiple ways of coming up with the substantive procedure. The first method is think about AEIOU. So A means comparisons, analytical procedures. So I would like to compare, let's say, the receivable amount for this particular year, particularly on a month-by-month basis, with the last year. And if there is any particulates or significant difference, I need to have a discussion with the management. So that's first procedure. Usually, for the sake of receivable and for the sake of valuation, usually there is an allowance. So I would like to have an inquiry with the management or a discussion with the management regarding the assumptions they have used when they were creating an allowance for the trade receivables. And I would like to make sure that their assumptions are adequate and reasonable under the given circumstances. AEIOU. Inspection or you recalculation. I get the breakdown of the year-end receivable and cast it in order to make sure that everything adds up correctly, or there is no arithmetical mistake in it. AEIOU, inspection. Can I inspect any document? Usually the valuation of receivable has got to do with certain receivables. So inspect the correspondence between the receivable, between customers, for example, a particular customer having dispute with the client, and try to understand whether the amount will be recoverable from that particular client. Because if that amount is not recoverable, it means that if this receivable is still recognized, that receivables is overstated, they are not correctly valued. How to verify evaluation? Imagine last procedure. Imagine, although we required only three, but this is fifth or sixth procedure. Now imagine the client has recognized receivable of, let's say, 1.2 million at the year end in the statement of financial position. How can you verify the valuation of it? You might wish to inspect the post year end. What do I mean by post year end? After the balance sheet date, after the year end, inspect the post year end bank statement and cash day book in order to verify whether 1.2 million has now received or converted into cash. If it has been converted into cash, that verifies not only the valuation, but also the existence of the valuation receivable as well. Is this clear to everyone? Yes, Sarosh, you might want to have a discussion with the management regarding the allowance for the doubtful debt. You are right. So can I have, for the sake of receivable, you might want to calculate and compare the receivable collection period and compare it with the last year. If it is significantly on the higher side, if there is a significant increase in the receivable collection period, that creates doubt on the valuation of receivable because some of the receivable are not going to pay. Well done. Bank statements. Yes, Rabia, you should inspect the post year end bank statement, not the year end bank statement. The post year, let's imagine your year end is August. So you would like to inspect the bank statement of October, November, in order to verify whether those receivables have now been converted into cash. If they have been converted into cash, that will be reflected in the bank statement. You're absolutely right. Khalil, you are right. But if you are going to contact the receivables and if you are going to verify from those directly, that will verify the existence. But I'm not sure whether they are going to pay or not. So valuation will not be verified up to that extent. Okay, Rabia. Yes, Sonam, policy of allowance should be reasonable because that has got to do with valuation. Yes, Gautam, subsequent receivable. Yes, inspect the post year end bank statement and cash day book. You're right. You're right. Neha, what's bothering you? Please let me know what point you are not getting. Okay, apart from Neha, everyone is crystal clear. Fantastic. I'm loving it. Sarah, you're right. You can compare the prior year closing balance. But you should do it when you were casting it. Just make sure that the opening balance is exactly from the last year's closing balance. Inquiry part with respect to what? You might want to have a discussion with the management. That's inquire and have a discussion with the management and try to understand what assumptions they have made regarding the allowance for the doubtful debt. And make sure their assumptions are reasonable. Is this clear now? Thank you, Neha. Yes, Sahar, you are absolutely right. Get the age receivable analysis and try to identify old receivables and have a discussion with the management or request the management whether those old receivables need to be written off. Well done. Because if they need to be written off, obviously that has got implications with the valuation of receivable. Fantastic. That's it. We are too good. We don't need to invest more time on that. And I really don't think so that we need to invest time on the solution. But if somebody is having tension of it. I am having a break, personal break of 30 seconds or 60 seconds. All of you have got this time to read these solution. There is one point which we missed out that we might want to review the board minutes, baby, because we might want to review the board minutes in order to verify if there is any significant concern or attention going on regarding the payment from a particular customer. If that is the case, that needs to be written off. So again, this has got to do with the valuation. Please read all the procedures by yourself. Gautam, I didn't get your question. Sir, in the same question, when do we use EVCR? After all, receivable has got to do with statement of financial position. So basically, you are verifying EVCR, but the examiner has asked you not to verify E, not to verify C, not to verify R, but stick to V only. Okay, Gautam? Kabir, I think I've missed your question. Can we agree the opening receivable balance with the last year balance to ensure the correct value is brought down? Yes, and then add them up or cast them to make sure that the closing balance is accurate. Yes, Akbar. Yes, Kabir, you're right. Okay, very sweet question. For 3 marks, how many procedures do we need to write? 1 procedure, 1 mark. So for 3 procedures, maximum 3 marks. That's it. Okay, we are done. We are done. Okay, somebody has asked me to please explain the second procedure. I want to obtain the breakdown of the opening allowance. Basically, I want to get the opening allowance for the doubtful debt. And I want to make sure whether that allowance was reasonable, whether the actual bad debts were more than the allowance or the actual bad debts were less than the allowance. If God forbids, the actual bad debts were more than the allowance, which means the allowance created by the client for this year could be wrong as well. And as a result, receivables might be overstated. Their valuation might be incorrect. Is this clear? Go for the easier procedures. Can we apply common procedures no matter whatever assertion is asked? I don't get this question. Common procedures. Yes, you can apply common procedures, but what common? AEIOU, yeah? Okay, let's continue. Okay, there was another question, part E, which we skipped on the other day. Describe the substantive procedures the auditor should perform to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence in relation to the. So the requirement is same up to this point. In relation to what? In relation to the disposal of plant and machinery in the current year. So your client has disposed of a certain plant and machinery in the current year, and you need to perform substantive procedures on that. First of all, I need to get the breakdown of the disposal, and I need to make sure that all those things which have been disposed by the client have been removed from the non-current asset register. For certain, if there are not many disposals, let's say there are 2-3 disposals only, I would like to recalculate the profit or loss on disposal just to make sure that the disposal calculation performed by the client is up to the mark. In order to verify whatever the profit or loss on disposal the client has recognized, I would like to inspect the disposal proceeds or the supporting documents, such as the sales invoice, such as the sundry sales invoice, just to make sure that they have correctly performed the calculation. Whatever they have disposed, I would like to review all that in accordance with IS 16, just to make sure that they have fully disclosed all their disposals, the profits, the losses, in accordance with IS 16. Is this clear to everyone? Oh, yes, you would like to make sure that the depreciation has been correctly charged. Say, for example, the disposal happened on after the 8th month. So make sure depreciation has been charged for the 8 months and not for the next 4 months, something like that. Maybe according to the policy, some of the companies do not charge this depreciation at all at the disposal year. So whatever the policy is, well done, well done. Saroj, do not review the post year and non-current asset register. Review the current year's non-current asset register. Make sure that those things which have been disposed are removed in the current year. Don't go for the post year. You are right, but that word post year is not right. Yes, for the sake of disposal proceeds, you can check the market rate or the industry rate or the, you know, Mushna, you are right. Yes, Shafad, you are absolutely right. Yes, Somya, you according to the disposal, the policy, depreciation policy, we need to make sure everything is all right. Oh, Sahar has come up with a very good procedure that we need to make sure that the same amount of the proceeds are reflected in the bank statement and cash report. Well done. Well, yes, Sarah, you are absolutely right. Okay, well, enough. Yes, yes, Karavani, you are absolutely right. So we are okay. More substantive procedures. That was a question called Raspberry. Okay, we skipped the last part of Raspberry. Describe the substantive procedures the auditor should perform to confirm the year-end accrual for tax payable on employment income. Let that sink in. Please absorb that. What the requirement is saying. Describe the substantive procedures the auditor should perform to confirm what? The client recognizes a liability or an expense called accrual for tax payable on employment income. So there is an organization in which there are many, many employees. The employer is supposed to deduct their tax and they are supposed to pay to the tax authorities. And for that, they create an accrual for tax payable on employment income. You need to apply procedures on that. Okay, start with AEIOU. Can you apply A here? Anyone? Can we apply A here? Yes, Sarah, you are absolutely right. Compare the accruals for this particular year, specifically with the last year. And if there is any significant fluctuation or difference, you got to investigate that. Fantastic. Fantastic. Comparing the amounts with the last year. Well done. AE. E for inquire. And inquire and confirmation. Confirmation are from third parties, and third parties reminds me of the tax authority. Can I review the correspondence between the tax authorities and my client in order to verify if there is any dispute or any complication going on regarding the tax payment, which might reveal that the accrual is not up to the mark? Can I have a yes? Yes, tax authorities. Well done. All those who are mentioning tax authorities, fantastic. Can I recalculate the accrual by myself? AEIOU, recalculation. I'm straight away going towards. Can I recalculate it by myself according to the tax laws, according to the whatever the rules and regulations are? Yes, I can recalculate the tax amount. Can I get the breakdown of the accrual and cast it to make sure there is no arithmetical mistake? Recalculation and re-performances. Can I have a yes on that? Well done. Inspect the post year and bank statement and cash day book in order to verify that the same amount which was accrued has been paid. Well done, Sarah. Fantastic. Yes, Shriya. Yes, Somya. You're absolutely right. Yes, Akbar. Absolutely right. Okay. Navneet has asked, what is cost? Cost means to get the breakdown and then add it up. It's doing maths. You know, it's a methodology. It's a terminology used to verify the arithmetical accuracy. Navneet, are you clear now? Oh, fantastic. From Neha, she's saying we need to inspect the or review the disclosures in accordance with the tax laws. Fantastic. Yes, Maz, you are absolutely right. Yes, Ajwa, you are absolutely right. Fantastic. Yes, inspect the bank statement and cash day book in order to verify post year and bank statement and cash day book, Sarosh, in order to verify that the accruals were not understated. The same amount or more or less same amount has been paid. Fantastic. You guys are doing a great job. Let's see what the solution has to offer. First of all, read the solution of this disposal of plant and machinery. I'm giving you 30 seconds for that. I'm going to scroll down the screen. read these procedures as well, please. Aska has asked, is it necessary to write the source? See, a complete, a fantastic substantive procedure would mean that you need to use AEIOU, you need to use DADA3, and you need to use assertion. When you are going to blend all these three ingredients, you will come up with a savory biryani, a delicious substantive procedure. So make sure you are using all those ingredients. Okay, what about the substantive procedures for the accruals? So here it is. Please, you have got very important 60 seconds at your disposal right now. Substantive procedures for the tax payable accrual. Go on and read them. Is this clear? All these procedures are clear to everyone. Can I have a yes? Oh, okay, Hashir, if you are starving, I'm not going to discuss food. Reperform the calculation of the accrual to confirm accuracy and discuss unexpected variances with the management. So the source of evidence is management. You are having a discussion with the management. Even the source of evidence is the accounting books and records, because you are reperforming the calculation performed by the management. Is this clear? Why don't we compare tax rates, which rates used by the authorities? You are reviewing the disclosures just to make sure that they have followed the accounting the tax laws and regulations. So Sarosh, the thing which you are referring will be verified through the disclosure notes. The same rates I have been used. Okay, Sarosh. Okay, what about Frisia? It had also a question on substantive procedure. Describe the substantive procedure the auditor should perform to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence in respect of the Frisia company's year-end accrual for employment tax payable. So it's the same question. I think I can skip that. Are you all clear? Can I have yes? Because I'm moving towards a bigger event now. Okay, guys, now please realize there are two possible ways through which substantive procedures could be tested. There are two ways in which substantive procedures can be tested by the examiner. The first methodology of testing, by the way, the requirement will always be the same. And what that is, describe the substantive procedures the auditor should perform in order to verify the same requirement. There are two ways an examiner could test substantive procedures. Method number one is, examiner is not going to come up with a story such as this one. Examiner is not going to come up with a story. Rather than the story, examiner is going to straight away ask you, describe the substantive procedures for the year-end tax accrual. No background story as such. There is a minor story over here, but that is not a lengthy story. Without any story, such as this one, we did substantive procedure for the valuation of receivables, substantive procedure for the disposal of plant. But there is second methodology used by the examiner in the question three of the section B. And that is, examiner is going to give you a background story and then you got to apply substantive procedure. So let's go to a very important question called gooseberry. So day before yesterday, we did a question called blackberry. Yesterday we did raspberry, and now today gooseberry. These are all from a particular one particular past paper. I think it's from December 2018, fairly recent. Let's go to the requirement. Describe the substantive procedures the auditor should perform to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence in relation to G company research and development expenditure. So the client has performed certain research and development, and obviously they had certain expenditure. You got to verify and you got to perform substantive procedures. 5 marks, which means 5 procedures. Okay, let's start reading the story. And before we go on to the story, there is a background information. You are an audit manager of Cranberry and Company, and you are currently responsible for the audit of Gooseberry and Company, a company which develops and manufactures health and beauty products and distribute these to wholesale customers. Its draft profit before tax is 6.4 million and total assets are 37.2 million. These amounts are available for you for the sake of last part of this question, which we are going to solve tomorrow. The final audit is due to commence shortly, and the following matters have been brought to your attention. Let's start reading the story number one. For that, we need 5 procedures. G company spent 1.9 million in the current year developing 9 new health and beauty products. So the company has already spent 1.9 million. The first procedure which comes in my mind, my favorite one, can anyone give me what's that procedure? Yes, Sara, Neha, Somya. Yes, you, all of you, the next 10 students, all of you are absolutely right. You got to obtain the breakdown or the schedule of the intangible assets, cast it, making sure that the opening balances are correct, making sure that they have charged the amortization expense, making sure that the closing balance is absolutely right. So this is the first procedure. Okay. Once they meet the recognition criteria under IAS 38 intangible assets for development expenditure, G company includes the cost incurred within intangible assets. Now you have to have a discussion with the finance director or with the management and make sure all those items which they have capitalized as an intangible asset, they genuinely meet the capitalization criteria. In fact, you might want to seek the supporting documents in order to verify that those items genuinely meet the capitalization criteria. And if there is any item which does not meet the capitalization criteria, needs to be written off as an expense. By the way, research expense can never be capitalized as a development expenditure. Once production commences, the intangible assets are amortized on a straight line basis over 3 years. Do you have any clue, any substantive procedure in your mind about this 3 years? Anyone? Yes, Sara, you are absolutely right. Yes, Mapupi, you are absolutely right. Yes, Neha, there are 2 procedures. A, you got to have a discussion with the management or the finance director regarding the rationale, regarding the assumptions they have used for the 3 year period, and make sure their assumptions are reasonable in accordance with the business, in accordance with the situation. More importantly, you might want to recalculate the amortization expense for the intangible assets and make sure they are in line with the policy of 3 years, and there is no arithmetical mistake in it. Management believes that this amortization policy is a reasonable approximation of the asset's useful life, and as in this industry, there is a constant demand for innovation, for innovative new products. So any more procedure? Make sure whatever they have expensed out have been charged to the profit or loss account. Make sure whatever they have capitalized, seek the supporting documents and make sure it does meet the capitalization criteria. Last but not the least, what you can do, you can review the market research made by the company and make sure that their market research is indicating that all these 9 products will be converted into a sellable product and the economic benefits will arise. Only then they are allowed to recognize that. Last but not the least, review the disclosure notes and make sure that the client has fully disclosed everything in accordance with IAS 38 intangible assets. Is this clear to everyone? If your IAS 38 is strong, I think you will be able to score 5 marks. Yes, in order to ensure the availability of resources, you got to have you got to review the market research report, Sarah. You got to review the market research report. Yes, operand disclosures in accordance with IAS 38. Yes, Shafad, you are absolutely right. Yes, Khalil Rahman, and yes, Akbar, about ownership, you can review the you can review the minutes of the meetings and try to figure out what is the point of view regarding the completion and the, you know, technical feasibility. What's the point of view of the directors? You can review the minutes of the meetings. Well done. Okay, Neha has asked, can we use the disclosures for every substantive procedure? You have got to think like an accountant, whether that particular item requires disclosures in accordance with a certain accounting standard. If the answer is yes, now think like an auditor. Will you be interested in the disclosure notes? If the answer is yes, yes, you can apply the this particular procedure. Ajwa is asking, can you please explain market research point? See, the client has recognized the expenditure made for all those 9 projects, and they have recognized all that amount as an intangible asset. IAS 38 says only that amount can be recognized against which a sellable product and economic benefit will arise to the company. So I am interested in the market research report regarding those 9 products in order to figure out whether the company will be able to create a sellable product. That is why I'm interested in the market research report, Ajwa. If the market report is going to suggest that all 9 products will be transformed into sellable product, I believe that their recognition criteria is fulfilled and they are allowed to recognize that as an intangible asset. Is this clear? Yes, Sarah, that could be a possibility, but that would be highly technical. Don't go for that. Yes, Adil, you are right. All of you are right. Well done. Let's see what the solution has to offer so that we could feel a bit more confident. Okay, all of you are having 2 minutes. Please read all the points and try to understand them. This is recalculation. This is agreeing with the accounting books and records. This is discussion. This is recalculation of the depreciation expense. This is again having a discussion. This is again making sure that they have performed calculations in the correct manner. Is this clear to everyone? If it is clear, please read these procedures as well. The last three. Rational can be exchanged for basis. Yes, yes, you can. If you could use the word rational, that's a powerful word. Saroj has come up with a sweet question. That is, please mention some areas which require disclosures. Provisions require disclosures. The recognition criteria of IAS 38 required disclosures. If there is a certain impairment, IAS 36, that requires disclosures. stick to your standards, Sarosh, the one I told you earlier, the list. Yes, going concern, I've got disclosure, Shriya, thank you. Okay, are we done with this? Can I have yes, please? Okay, Claire, fantastic, fantastic. Let's go to the next part. Gooseberry, the requirement is describe substantive procedure the auditor should perform to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence in relation to the matters identified regarding the depreciation of the property, plant, equipment. I believe this is an easier one for you. Depreciation of property, plant, equipment. G company has a large portfolio of property, plant, equipment. In March 2017, what's the year end? January 2018. So during the year, not at the start of the year. In March 2017, the company carried out a full review of its property, plant, equipment and updated the useful lives, residual values, depreciation rates and methods for many categories of assets. The finance director felt the changes were necessary to better reflect the use of the assets. This resulted in the depreciation charge of some of the assets changing significantly for this year. Now, please do not compare the depreciation expense for this particular year with the last year. Why I'm saying that, please do not compare. Yes, all of you are right that we need to have a discussion with the management regarding the changes and make sure their changes are rational. You are right. But why we are not going to compare? Because the comparability phenomena requires consistency. And the question itself has revealed that the things have significantly changed this year. So you can't compare this year values with the last year. Yes, the policies are different. Yes, the useful lives have changed. Yes, the revaluation has occurred. So we can't compare. Fantastic, all of you. Well done. Yes, policies and estimates have changed, Ashir. Fantastic, well done. Now go back to the question. And what about the procedure? The first procedure has been revealed by many of you, that is having a discussion with the management. Second one, we got to make sure whatever assumptions now they are applying, whatever useful lives rates they are applying, they are consistent with, now I can compare. They are consistent with what? Can you please tell me in the question section? Not comparing with the last year's result, but comparing with something else. Yes, sir, you are absolutely right. I would like to make sure that it is in line with the industry average or the business knowledge I have. Fantastic, two procedures. Now, I would like to review the non-current asset register in order to assess that the depreciation has been charged on revised rates. Maybe you would like to recalculate the depreciation expense in order to make sure that the depreciation is charged correctly or in accordance with the revised policies and it has been properly time apportioned. If there were significant disposals, you might want to calculate the profit or losses on disposals and make sure that those profit or those disposals have been removed from the non-current asset register. Last but not the least, you might want to review the disclosure notes, Sarosh, and you want to make sure that they have correctly disclosed the change in policy, the depreciation, the losses on disposals in line and or in accordance with I-16 property, plant, equipment. Is this clear to everyone? Yes, Khalil, you are absolutely right. Changes. Is this clear to everyone? Yes, Rabia, if there is a depreciation or if there is a significant increase in useful life or a change in depreciation rates, you might want to inspect the asset in just to make sure that the physical condition of that asset is good enough. Yes, Gautam, you're right. Try to stay focused on depreciation. Okay, you have got time. Please read these procedures. Please read. Do not skip them. Please concentrate. Remember, if there is significant profit or losses on disposal, that indicates that the depreciation policy used by the client is not up to the mark. Remember, if the client has got a huge capital expenditure budget in the upcoming years, it's an indication that the client, if the client is having huge useful life up ahead, that is not correct, because if the capital expenditure budget is suggesting that the client needs to have a capital expenditure after 2 years, but the non-current asset is still having useful life of 5 years, that's a contradiction. So usually the capital expenditure budget is an indication about the appropriateness of the depreciation policy and useful life. Is this clear to everyone? Can I have yes on that? Yes, Azhar, you are absolutely right. Disclosures should be the think practically, Azhar. Once you have completed the whole audit, only then you are going to review the disclosures that are in order to make sure that everything which has been disclosed is correct. Can we see the board minutes to see the rationale for changes? I don't think so. I think it's far better to go and have a discussion directly with the directors. But if there is a significant change about a particular asset, a significant impairment, a significant increase, upward revaluation, for that you might want to review the board minutes. Not completely wrong. Ajwa, can you please repeat? Ajwa, what you would like me to repeat? I missed it out, please. Point three. Review the capital expenditure budget. The capital expenditure budget for any particular company should be in line with the useful lives. So Harsher, if your capital expenditure budget is saying that you will need to spend after 3 years, but your non-current assets are suggesting useful life of 5 years. Now, is this a valid contradiction between the two things? Usually the capital expenditure budget and the useful lives are in line. But if the capital expenditure budget and the useful life is not in line, it's an indication that your estimate regarding the useful life is not right. Obviously, that leads to incorrect depreciation, incorrect valuation. Is this clear to you now, Harsher and Ajwa? Fantastic, Ajwa and Harsher, fantastic. Sir, but is the link between capital expenditure and useful life? Yes, Akbar, there is a link between capital expenditure and the useful life of assets, and as a result, the depreciation expense. Varta is asking, sir, there is a comparison with prior year in 0.7. What prior year? 0.7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Obtain a breakdown of depreciation by asset category compared to prior year where significant changes have occurred. Discuss with management and assess whether this change is reasonable. Ignore this point. This is not a valid point, because there are significant changes. There is no sense of comparing depreciation. If let's say for a particular asset there is no change, only then you can compare. Akbar is saying, what's the link? The link is the capital expenditures are made by the companies when their useful life is over, done and dusted. So if the useful life is 5 years, the capital expenditure should be after 5 years. But if you are planning to do capital expenditure after 2 years and your useful life is 5 years still remaining, what does that mean, Akbar? It means that the estimates of the useful life are not correct. Is this clear, Akbar, now? Yes, if you are going to compare the depreciation policy, then it's all right. Then you can compare things. Otherwise, no. Okay, then another part, the last part of this question is called is about bonus and director bonuses. So we need to apply substantive procedures in relation to director bonuses. The company's board is comprised of 7 directors. They are each entitled to a bonus based on the draft year-end net assets excluding intangible assets. So one of the substantive procedure could be that you need to review the you need to recalculate the bonus payment, and you need to make sure that the bonus payment is based upon the strict criteria of excluding the intangible assets. Make sure that the bonus is based upon the assets, not incorporating the intangible assets. Okay, detail of the bonus entitlements are included in the direct service contract. So you got to make sure that the bonus is in line with the director service contract. That's another procedure. Then what? To bonus which related to 2018 year end was paid to each director in February 2018, and the costs were accrued and recognized within the wages and salaries for the year ended 31st January 2018. You can compare this year's bonus with the last year, and if there is any significant change, you got to have a discussion and make sure their assumptions are reasonable and in accordance with the business situation. Separate disclosure of the bonus by the director is required according to local law. Sarosh, are you having any procedure in your mind right now after reading this? Separate disclosure. Anyone? Yes, the relevant disclosure should be made, and that should be adequate, and that should be in accordance with the local laws and regulations. Don't inspect the disclosure. Review the disclosure, Neha. That is how we lose marks in the exam. Yes, Sarosh, we don't have to make the adequate disclosure. We need to review and make sure the adequate disclosure is there in accordance with the local laws. Fantastic. Please read the solution so that we can move on. And there are a few easy procedures as well, such as review the individual bonus payments to the payroll records. You can recalculate the bonus according to the policy. You can get the breakdown of the bonus and make sure it is accurate. Make sure that bonus is part of the accruals. Please read the solution. Yes, agree the bonus payment from the bank statement and cash day book. Well done. Can we use board minutes for the director thing, for the bonuses? Make sure that the bonuses have been agreed in the board minutes. Yes, sir, Fatma, you are absolutely right. We can review the board minutes in order to verify the approval of the bonus. Yes, Ahmed, you are right. We can see the liability schedule to make sure that bonus payment were classified as an accrual, as a current liability. Well done. Okay, we are done with 15 marks because we did three parts each having 5 marks. What about the last part? Discuss the issue. So we got to discuss the issue, and that will give us mark. And by having the discussion of the issue, we need to copy many things from the question. Describe the impact on the auditor's report, but we haven't studied the audit report as yet. If any, should this issue remain unresolved? So this part D, we will be covering this part D tomorrow. 99% of the worldwide students, when they are going to attempt the double A in the September 2021 attempt, they are going to get this 5 mark part. I will tell you how convenient, how easy, and how sweet and polite these 5 marks are. But for that, you have to attend tomorrow's webinar. I will teach you, and I will tell you what's audit report, and I will tell you how to score 5 out of 5 in this one. So for now, for the time being, we are going to skip this particular part, and you got to remind me, we will cover it up tomorrow. Don't worry. Is this clear to everyone? Yes, piece of cake. Absolutely. Okay. I would like to solve another question before we go on to OTQs. We will go to OTQs. So there are three parts again. The first part, trade payable. Second part, trade receivable. Third part. Let's read the background. It's a past paper question. You are an audit manager of Snail and Company, and you are in charge of two audits which are due to commence shortly. Insects for You Company is a registered charity which promotes insect conservation and has been an audit client for several years. Spider Spirals Company, also an existing client. So there are two clients. First client is called Insects for You, and the second client is called Spider Spirals. Also an existing audit client which manufactures stationery products, and its draft total liabilities are 8.1 million. Both clients' financial year ended on 31st October 2016. The following matters have been brought to your attention for each company. Okay, so there are three parts. Let me read the requirement number three first. I would like to go in reverse order. Describe substantive procedures the auditor should perform to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence in relation to the company's trade receivables. This is too easy. Trade receivables. All of you have got 2 minutes to read this question first. Okay then, AEIOU, is there anything which you can compare? They have already calculated the receivable days, which has gone up from 34 days to 55 days. So you can't compare the receivable days, right? You can't compare the receivable days. AEIOU. So there is a huge chances, there is a significant possibility that their year-end receivables might be overstated. I think the procedures should be focused on valuation, because the receivable seems to be overstated. What we can do is that we need to inspect the age receivable of the client, and we need to identify the slow moving items. And if there is any slow moving item, we need to have a discussion with the management whether they need to write them off. We need to review the correspondence between the client and customers. Maybe we will be able to identify if there is any dispute going on. Inspect the post year end bank statement and cash day book in order to verify whether those slow moving items, whether those receivables have now been converted into cash. Can we get an evidence from the board directors of minutes of the meetings? Yes, we would like to review the board minutes in order to identify whether there is any significant concern about a particular debt. Similarly, you need to have a discussion with the management regarding the allowance for the doubtful debt and make sure their assumptions are reasonable. Is this clear to everyone? Because the allowance is 1.5%. You need to have a discussion on that. Last but not the least, you can get the breakdown of the year-end receivable and cast it to ensure the arithmetical accuracy. disclosure regarding the allowance, it's not that critical disclosure. Are you all clear with this? Can I have yes regarding receivables, because that was too easy? Can I have yes? Okay, Ahmed, Neha. Okay, okay, Ushna, Sarosh, Navneet, Shriya, Katwani, Sonam, Angelina, fantastic. How credit controller's vacancy would affect it? If the credit controller is not there, that creates doubt in my skeptic mind that because of the absence of credit controller, there is a huge possibility that the debts are not properly chased up. And as a result, the chances of bad debts are on the higher side. And as a result, the receivables might be overstated at the year end. So I've got reservations for the valuation of receivable. Is this clear, Rabia, now? Fantastic. Yes, yes, Burhanuddin. Yes. Ajit is asking the same questions about confirmation from the customers on the balance. Yes, it's a valid procedure. You can perform the circularization if you are allowed to, but what does the question says? yeah, you can perform the circularization if you want to. Okay. Okay. Because we are done with receivables, I'm ignoring payables for now and I'm going for the income. Last part for the day. Insects for You Company is a not-for-profit organization which generates income in a number of ways. So it's a not-for-profit organization and they generate income. It receives monthly donations from its many subscribers and these are paid by bank transfer to the charity. In addition, a large number of donations are sent through the post to the charity. Insects for You Company also sells tickets for their 3 charity events held annually. During the audit planning, completeness of income was flagged as a key risk. So as an auditor, you have got reservation in your mind that maybe they have omitted something. Completeness of income was flagged as a key risk. Describe the substantive procedures you should perform to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence in relation to the completeness of the income. Procedures for the completeness of the income. First of all, you got to get the breakdown of the year, of their revenue, of their income, and cast it to confirm that they have not missed anything out. This will verify the completeness and the accuracy. Then can you compare the income? Yes, on a category by category basis, because they generate income in number of ways. So on a category by category basis, you can compare this year's income with the last year. And if there is any significant difference, you need to have a discussion with the management. There are monthly donations sent through post. So there are many subscribers. So you can select a sample of donations, trace those donations in the bank statement and cash book, and make sure they have been completely recorded. If the bank statement and cash book is reflecting, make sure the income is also reflecting that. Okay. During Inspect for You Company sells tickets for their 3 charity events held annually. So you can perform recalculate the revenue generated through charity events by using average data, average number of tickets sold, average price, and make sure that same amount has been recognized by the client. Is this clear to everyone? Can I have yes on that? Yes, sequence of ticket check should be performed in order to ensure completeness of income. Yes. Could there be a procedure on IFRS? See, IAS and IFRS is for now try to absorb and try to understand, it's one and the same thing. But only those accounting standards are directly tested in AA exam, which are part of your F3 syllabus. Otherwise, we had a flavor of IFRS 15 revenue recognition on the day one of the webinar. How to verify charity event tickets? Ajwa is asking. Okay, last question for now. How to verify charity event tickets? Wait. for the charity events, Ajwa, you got to undertake a proof in total calculation. How are you going to take a proof of the total calculation? Simply get the total tickets sold multiplied by the ticket price. Let's say 100 tickets sold, every ticket had price of 10. So 100 into 10, 1000. Make sure they have recognized 100 as their income. If they haven't, you need to have a discussion with the management. Is this clear, Ajwa? Can I have clear and yes from all of you? I would like to move to the OTQs now. We are running out of time. Your target should be that you need to type and learn these two substantive procedure questions today. Tomorrow we'll be doing more 2-3 questions. Don't worry. The last 10 minutes or 15 minutes of the webinar and the most important part. Today we have to solve OTQs regarding the most challenging portion. Okay then, are you all ready for the OTQs? Will you be willing to answer? Are you ready? Shafar, yes, you can get the Kaplan kit. I'll share the Kaplan kit and book in the group. Are you all ready for the OTQs? Okay then. I would like to start from the second OTQ first. Second OTQ first. You are an audit senior in Jones and Company and you are currently performing the final audit of Walker Company for the year ended 31st October 2016. So remember, the year end is 31st October 2016. The company is a manufacturer and retailer of shoes and boots. The current audit senior is ill and you have been asked to complete the audit of payroll and revenue in their absence. Okay, so you need to work on behalf of him. Okay, this is the story about payroll and this is a story about revenue. Now concentrate. You determine the following information from a review of the current year and prior year audit files. Now what you have identified as at 31st October 2015, which is basically the year end, last year end. What's the current year end? Oh, what's the current year end? 31st October 2016. So basically at the beginning of the current year or at the beginning of the current year or at the end of the last year, the company had 500 employees. On 1st November, that is after 1 month, 10% staff were made redundant. You must be familiar with the terminology called redundant. By the way, examiner could ask you to perform substantive procedures on the redundancy provision. Okay. Same logic. What assumptions they have used, inspect the post year and bank statement to verify the actual payments, cast it and to verify that mathematical accuracy, verify the disclosures in accordance with IS-37. Okay, fine, move on. 10% of the staff are made redundant. 500, the 10% of 500 is 50, that is 50 employees were gone due to discontinuation of a product line on 1st January. 1st January means November, December, okay, after 2 months. All the remaining staff received a 6% pay rise. So the pay rise will be applied to 10 months, not to 12 months. Over the course of the year, sales levels met performance targets, which resulted in a fixed bonus of 1500 being paid to each employee at the end of the year. How many employees got the bonus? 450, not the 500, because 10% were gone. 450 multiplied by 1500 will give you the bonus. Okay, that was a hectic calculation. Now please go to the 103. The prior year financial statements for Walker Company included 17 million for wages and salaries. What would be the estimated current year wages and salaries expense, ignoring redundancy cost? You have to ignore the redundancy cost, but you don't have to ignore the redundancy program. You have to ignore 50 employees, they are redundant. So perform the calculations, guys. Everyone, calculator, do it. up till now, I have received just one correct answer from Subaiba. Many of you are ignoring the fact that bonus payment needs to be incorporated. Shreya, you are right. Many of you are ignoring that 50 employees have gone. Many of you are ignoring that the pay rise will be applicable on 10 months, not on 12 months. Yes, Shreya, you are right. Yes, Halima, you are right. I just wanted to highlight this question just to make you realize how important it is to have calculations, even if it is an audit paper. The correct answer is option A, not option B or C. I'm not going to invest time on the calculations for now, but I hope you can do it at home by yourself. Simply, first of all, you have to make sure that you reduce this 17 million by 10%, because the 10% employees have gone. So first of all, reduce this 17 million by 10%. Then that particular amount needs to be divided into two portions. The first portion will be time apportioned, 2 months divided by 12 months, and you are not supposed to inflate that. But the next 10 months out of 12 months, you need to inflate that by what? 6%. Whatever the answer is, you need to add bonus in it. How to calculate bonus? $1,500 multiplied by 450. Is this clear to everyone now? Yes, Azhar. The answer is option A. Okay, then, done. The following audit procedures are included in the revenue section of the audit plan. Review the treatment of sample of post year end returns. Select a sample of good dispatch notes and agree to invoices in the sale day book. Select a sample of good dispatch notes. If good dispatch note is, I'm selecting a sample from good dispatch note, it means I don't have doubt on occurrence, and I'm verifying it in the sales book. This is a procedure for completeness. Select a sample of invoices from the sales book and agree to good dispatch note. This is a procedure for occurrence. Select a sample of invoices and recalculate the invoice amount agreeing to the price list. That's accuracy. Review the treatment of sample of post year end returns. If there are post year end sales return and I am reviewing the accounting treatment, I just want to make sure that those post year end sales returns have not been recognized by the client as a revenue, because they do not exist, or that let's assume that those transactions never happened. Okay, then, now it's time to start the question. We have read the whole question. 101. Which of the following statements explain the cutoff assertion for wages and salaries? All of you have got 1 minute. Read all the four options. Which of the following statement explains the cutoff? Cutoff has got to do with the accounting period. What's the current client's accounting period? 31st October 2016. All of you have got 1 minute. Neha, correct. Gautam, correct. Halima, correct. Abdullahad, correct. Shreya, correct. Karthika, correct. Kalavani, not the option three. Rhea, not the option three. Dawn, not the option three. Option F does not exist. Only four options are there. The correct answer is option D. Wages and salaries accounted for whatever you have recognized. They must relate to the current year. That's what is cutoff says. Cutoff has got to do with the correct accounting period of the company, not the personal employees or personal things, right? That is why option D, not C. Let's go to the next question. The following audit evidence has been gathered relating to the accuracy of wages and salaries. The following evidence has been gathered regarding the accuracy of wages and salaries. You tell me which evidence is the most reliable. So you got to list them down, starting with the most reliable first. These are all procedures. These are all evidence. You got to arrange them in order of their reliability. Use your common sense, then I will explain. Yes, Akbar, you are right. Okay, 102. The correct answer is, remember, the evidence generated by the auditor is the most reliable one. So I need to place one at the top. Then comes, according to the reliability, a little less reliable is the evidence generated by the internal auditor. After all, they are also auditors, though internal auditors. So I need to place four after one. Now, written representation is generally considered as a weak evidence, but it is far better than the verbal confirmation. Verbal has got no evidence. Verbal communication is the least acceptable one. So the correct answer would be 1, 4, 2, 3, and that makes option 2 as the correct answer. Okay, we are already done with 103. 104, a very, 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 very important question. Select which two of the following are substantive analytical procedures for the wages and salaries. Somebody wants to verify wages and salaries, and somebody wants to apply comparisons. Out of these four, which two are substantive analytical? You have got 60 seconds to do that. Well done, Subhaya and Sara and Rabia. Rabia, you need to add one more. Oh, well, I warrant you need to add one more. Ajit, you are right. Rhea, you need to add one more because we need to identify two. Nabil, you are absolutely right. Sir, you are right. Pramudini, you are not right because A is not an analytical procedure. Shia, you are not right. Don, you are right. Navneet, you are right. Akbar, you are right. Rehan, you are right. Rhea, you are right. Maraba, you are not right because A is not a substantive procedure. Okay. There are many more answers. I can't name all of you. Okay. First, I need to identify two procedures. What is that? Compare. What is that? Compare. These two are the correct answers. This is recalculate. Recalculation means recalculation. It's not A. It's A-E-I-O-U. This is U, recalculation. And this is you are agreeing the amounts. This is again arithmetical accuracy. This is again calculation. Comparison means you are comparing this amount with another amount. So C and D, fantastic. Last question. In respect of the revenue procedures included in the audit plan, select the assertion being tested. Tell me which assertion is tested at 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's read them one by one. Let's read the first procedure. So this is the first. Let's do it in the reverse order. Let's read the fourth statement. Let's read the fourth statement. Now, this fourth statement is trying to verify which assertion? Accuracy, occurrence, completeness. Well done, well done. Accuracy, well done. The answer for question number 104 is last two options. Okay, let's read another procedure. select a sample of invoices from the sales day book and match it with the GDN. And read the statement number two as well. Select a sample of GDN and match it with the sales day book. So which one is occurrence and which one is completeness? When you are selecting a sample from GDN in the statement number two, you are not worried about the occurrence because GDN means it occurred. You are matching it or you are confirming it in the sales ebook. This is a procedure for completeness. And when you are selecting a sample from the sales ebook, you are matching it with the GDN. This is a procedure for occurrence. Last, review the treatment of sample of post year end returns. Why are you interested in post year end returns? Because you want to make sure that those year end returns, post year end returns, have been removed from the revenue. Because we have to assume that they never happened, they never occurred. So the first procedure is for assertion number one, which is occurrence. Is this clear to everyone? Well done, well done. Okay then. What's my suggestion for today? Before tomorrow's class, make sure that you have at least typed and learned these two substantive procedure questions called gooseberry insects for you and all those little parts from the lecture one and lecture two at least twice. So you got to make sure there was a substantive procedure part in Harlem, there was two substantive procedure parts in Raspberry, and there was another substantive procedure part in Frisia, and then we did these two questions. You got to make sure that before tomorrow's class you got to type everything and learn everything at least twice. Tomorrow will be a very, 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 very important day. Why I'm saying that? Because not only I'm going to continue with substantive procedures, but tomorrow I'm going to teach a very tricky topic of F8 syllabus, which is called audit reporting. So those who are interested in audit reporting, do not miss tomorrow's class. And those who want to capitalize on the knowledge of substantive procedures, stay tuned. If you have got any question for now, please go ahead. Otherwise, I need to sign it off. If there is any question, please go ahead. Nothing. Okay guys, thank you very much for your patience and thank you very much. I'll see you tomorrow. Please work on your substantive procedures. Thank you very much.